This podcast is brought to you on Roku and Fire TV by Pod Nation Podcast TV. Find us on X, Facebook, Instagram, or wherever podcasts are broadcast. Download our app and never miss a show with video on demand as well as exclusive content found only on Pod Nation TV.
Live from Seoul, South Korea, it's The Monster Island Film Vault, episode 87, Yongary, Monster from the Deep versus Neil Riebe. Hello, Kaiju Lovers, and welcome to The Monster Island Film Vault, a podcast seeking entertainment and enlightenment through tokusatsu. I am your host, Nate Marchand, the film curator on Monster Island, still on location for his world tour. And yes, my intrepid producer, Jimmy from NASA, who still has the worst mic in podcasting. Oh, okay. Sorry. Oh, I didn't mean to insult you so badly there. I'm just saying, man. For someone who is a NASA engineer, I don't understand how you can't get a functional mic. Just be glad that only the people who are hearing this out in the audience, the Kaiju Lovers, don't know what you're saying. But locally, we still do. But it's a little bit confusing. But you know who's not confusing? My guest for today's episode, Kaiju author extraordinaire and an unabashed Yongary fanboy, Neil Riebe.
Hey, Nate, how's it going?
Good Lord, man. You're going to become my most frequent guest. You're really gunning for most frequent guest on the show now. You know that?
Well, I am part of the tour now. I really have to say to the listeners, I have to, like, thank you on the air for changing the schedule of the tour. Come all the way to Seoul. I begged and begged, and I'm really grateful you came here so I could do, you know, a podcast with my buddy, Yongary.
Oh, I was going to say, yes. Yeah, you're doing the Lord's work, doing a bunch of research on Yongary, the film and the monster, and we're not talking about his like distant cousin or whatever, Double G, you know, that'll be next month's episode with Elijah, spoiler warning. But yeah, you know, you're talking about,
huh? You can take the fall for that one.
Oh, take the fall. Oh, somebody's got opinions. I can tell.
All right, that's my hot take for today.
I don't know if it's all that hot, to be honest.
Okay. Well, Elijah might not like that comment. He might beat me up later on. I'm gonna get back to the States.
Oh, you can take. Right there, you can take it. You can take Elijah. It's not that hard. I regret nothing, Elijah. We love you anyway. Okay, I don't need you to lecture me on how to treat children. All right.
Did he get that from Apex Industries? Holy cow.
Oh, the microphone? Oh, yeah. I'm starting to wonder, man. Wow. Don't bring Apex up to Jimmy. Jeez, what'd they do? Kill your robot dog? Calm down, man. Okay. You know, go get, like, a kiss on the cheek from Kaguya. That'll calm me down. Or a Snickers. A Snickers. Maybe that's what you need. All right? Just, yeah. Anyway, so yes, you followed us from Hong Kong over to here. That's much appreciated. Although I can tell you, we've only been here for a few weeks and we've already gotten into some crazy adventures. I didn't realize how strange haunted theme parks were until I came to Seoul. Yeah, me and Jake and Drew from the Cellcast all found out about that the hard way. Yeah, interesting stuff. Anyway, I know, I'm wasting all kinds of time, but first I need to remind everybody that
every country has a monster they're afraid of in their nation.
Every monster has a country, yeah, station they call their home.
Yes, we're here in Seoul for the next leg of the Monster Island World Tour to talk about the original Yongary, Monster from the Deep from 1967, the year of the kaiju, which now makes this, I think, as of this episode, I have talked about three of the six films from the year of the kaiju. Well, technically seven, if you have Wang Mogwai, but that episode is still coming. So, yeah.
Definitely an interesting year that, you know, that not only is Japan, you know, was having their first monster boom, that then, but at the same time, Korea had their first monster boom the same year, 1967. Yep. I mean, what a coincidence.
Well, and this one has Japanese connections, a lot of Japanese connections.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, but that's the funny thing. Yeah, we're going to be in South Korea, and technically North Korea, for the next several months because Korea really wanted to be like the other big home for kaiju. If it's not Japan, especially, or America, Korea's like, watch us. They really wanted to compete. They really wanted to compete. And man, we have a lot of Korean kaiju that we need to wrangle because the board said so. Good Lord. But yeah, so we're still trying to track Yongary, so you might get to see him up close and personal.
Oh, good. I can't wait.
Yeah, it should be exciting. And speaking of Japanese connections to a Korean film, that's actually going to play in very nicely with today's Toku topic, which will be Korea-Japan relations. Because, my word, they don't like each other and like each other and don't like each other. It's a storied history, to say the least.
Yeah, going back quite a long ways.
Going back a long ways, and so which makes the fact that this is a Korea-Japan co-production really impressive. Really, really impressive. But before we can get to that, Neil, I am contractually obligated to read Jimmy's entertaining info dump to get us all on the same page about this interesting little movie. The ravenous and aggressive Yongary is a dinosaurian kaiju awakened by Middle Eastern nuclear tests who travels to Panmunjom, South Korea. He rampages through Seoul in search of oil to consume as sustenance. He is presumably a mutated extraterrestrial, but this is never stated in the movie. Ko Il-woo, aka Ilo Nami, is an intelligent and brave scientist and inventor who is always trying to observe Yongary or find ways to combat him, which involves persuading government officials and throwing himself into harm's way. The clever but precocious Yu Young, aka Icho, is the movie's Kenny, and he spends most of the runtime trying to halt Yongary, but by the end feels sorry for the kaiju and half-heartedly tries to persuade the adults to not kill him. His older sister and Ilo's girlfriend, the sensible but supportive Yu Sung Ah, often serves as a voice of reason when Icho and Ilo try to endanger themselves to halt Yongary's rampage. Yu Kwang Nam is their smart and skilled older brother, a newlywed astronaut who observes the nuclear test that awakens Yongary, as well as the earthquakes created by the kaiju as he travels to South Korea. The affectionate and down-to-earth, no pun intended, Kim Yu Ri, aka Anna, is Kwang Nam's wife, who bemoans her new husband being called into action during their honeymoon and voices both concern and support during the actions taken against Yongary. While the human and kaiju plotlines are at first separate, they quickly unify once Yongary arrives in South Korea. The monster derails their normal lives and becomes the focus of their stories until the end. Yongary is the problem. He destroys a tank battalion when he goes to Seoul. He attacks a refinery and drinks the oil, but Icho shuts off the oil flow, enraging the monster. He destroys a tank in response, releasing a white cloud that weakens him. Ilo determines this was ammonia. He convinces the government to postpone a missile attack on Yongary and move the kaiju to a less populated area using burning oil, but Yongary doesn't take the bait. Icho uses Ilo's itching light ray to move him. Ammonia precipitate is dropped on Yongary before he's bombarded with missiles, but he survives the assault. Icho uses the itching ray on Yongary again, which, to his delight, makes the creature dance to a silent tune with him. Yongary survives another missile barrage and slices a military jeep in half with an energy beam from his horn. The monster then battles and destroys a squadron of fighter jets. The problem is solved when Ilo refines his ammonia formula and uses a helicopter to drop it on Yongary, who topples into a river and bleeds out. The script by director Kim Ki-duk and Seo Yun-sung is a simple sci-fi story that focuses on a family facing the kaiju threat. While it has some unrelated subplots early on, they're expositional and are quickly dropped when Yongary appears. This was the most expensive film ever made in South Korea at the time, costing 3 to 4 times as much to produce. Far East Entertainment employed artists and technicians from both the Equus Productions and Toei, including Kenichi Nakagawa and Gamera suit designer Masao Yagi, to train the South Korean crew to create kaiju special effects. Between the miniatures, sets, Yongary suit, and pyrotechnics, the special effects alone cost 13.7 million won, about $54,000 USD, to make. This combination of experienced mentors and an inexperienced crew makes the special effects uneven. The miniatures are effective, but not as polished as Toho's work. Director Kim Ki-duk was disappointed the Yongary suit wasn't scarier. It looks better from some angles than it does others. The fancy clothes worn by the actors were meant to create an illusion of a more prosperous South Korea. Overall, the movie looks on par with a Daya Gamera movie from the era. This movie has a light tone and moderate gravitas, but it sometimes vacillates between silliness and gruesomeness. Between spaceships, a giant fire-breathing lizard, and an itching ray, this is fantastical science fiction. While it had some kaiju-esque predecessors, this movie was the first of its kind in South Korea at the time. Tokusatsu-style special effects had never been attempted before, let alone at this scale, in this country. Given that anything Japanese was largely banned by the government and how expensive it was to produce, the studio was taking a huge risk making it despite audience interest in the kaiju genre. The movie reinforces the styles of 1960s Godzilla films and most especially Showa Gamera movies. Yongary himself is styled more after Godzilla with its design and origin, but the movie's story, tone, and characters, especially Icho, are more akin to Daya's Gamera series at the time. The movie was made to cash in on South Korean audiences' interest in Japanese kaiju media and its success. The year 1967 was the quote-unquote year of the kaiju, so the genre was at its peak of popularity. Secondarily and ironically, the movie may have been made as a pop cultural catharsis against Japanese colonialism. So, Yongary was meant to entertain a family audience, particularly children. When the movie opened at the Kukji Cinema in Seoul, August 13, 1967, it sold between 110,000 and 150,000 tickets, although some estimates go as high as 160,000. Any film selling more than 100,000 tickets was considered a success in South Korea. It became one of the first South Korean films released outside of its home country, premiering on U.S. television in 1969, courtesy of AIP, and in Germany and Italy in 1972. It's greatly appreciated by film aficionados in South Korea. Outside of there, while not held in as high a regard as its Japanese contemporaries, it's generally liked by both critics and kaiju fans. AIP's dub version removed the Korean language credits from the long panning shot in favor of English language text. Aside from that, only some nuances and minor details are lost in the dubbing and no footage is cut. Sadly, the prints of the original Korean language version of the movie have been lost and only 48 minutes have been found and stitched together. This makes the dub version the only surviving complete cut. Several forces are at play. Duty and familial obligation are at odds when Kwang Nam is called away for a mission during his honeymoon. The government withholds information from the public, fearing a panic, bringing safety and the right to know into conflict. Implicitly, militarism in the form of foreign nuclear tests has adverse effects on nature by causing earthquakes and awakening of the younger. Icho's childish antics frequently annoys the adults. Historical preservation is chosen over public safety when discussing military action against Yongary. Yongary's hunger clashes with humanity's energy needs because he consumes oil. Science, as represented by Ilo, dictates a course of action to the government by telling them not to launch missiles on Yongary. There are several themes in the movie. Implicitly, Japanese colonialism is criticized. Family is venerated because our protagonists come together to overcome the kaiju menace. Heritage and history is to be preserved. While his competence is inexplicable, Ichō's cleverness is presented as a positive. By extension, he shows that children shouldn't be ignored and can often have insights that are missed by adults. Science and not military might finds the solution to the problem. It comes too late, but Ichō argues that Yongary was innocent and simply trying to survive, reinforcing Ashira Honda's idea that kaiju are tragic creatures. Now that my contractual obligations are fulfilled, it's time for Toku Talk with Neil. All right, Neil, you are the Yongary, at least 1967, expert here. So where do we begin? Because you have even more notes than I do.
You know, let's kind of begin like with the kind of a technical achievement that this movie, you know, is. Before we even get into that, let's even get into about the whole story about how the movie got lost.
And yeah, because it is wild. This is the only movie of its kind I can think of where the dub version is the only one that has survived.
Well, now, here's the crazy thing, because, you know, when I was, you know, first did an article about the Korean cut for John LeMay, one of his monster books years ago.
Which will be cited in the bibliography for this episode.
Oh, okay, great. Yeah, it just sounded like it's just one of those kind of careless things that the BBC is doing with their own TV shows.
Doctor Who.
Yeah, you know, and you know, all their other programs. And I found some interesting blogs that talked about Korean films in general back during the 1960s. So by the 1960s, the late 1960s, the Korean film industry was producing about 200 movies a year.
Yeah.
Yeah, think of that, 200 movies a year. And now, of course, all these guys, all these film companies, very small budgets. We already discussed, you know, what a technical achievement that Yongary was for the Korean film industry. Because if you watch Wang Mangui, well, that's pretty much where they were at. So if anyone got their hands on that movie from SRS Cinema, you know exactly, you know, you compare those two movies, you know, and then you can really see that just how much effort went into making Yongary a good film.
Yeah, anyway, I think not long after you saw Wang Mangui, I think you messaged me and said, like, Wang Mangui is the Gamera to Yongary's Godzilla.
Yeah.
Which is interesting because I would argue that, as Jimmy pointed out in the entertaining info dump, that by Japanese standards, Yongary is closer to a Gamera movie.
Yeah, you know. But if you've seen listen to the Steve Rifle commentary from the Kino Lorber
Blu-ray, which I did get for the Film Vault, because nothing but the best for the Film Vault.
So we're dealing with a country, you know, that had a third world economy and bouncing back from the Korean War. And they only had a population of 25 million people and about 570 theater screens. And so we're talking about, you know, a very small market with a small economy. And anyway, so let's get to touch on the loss of that film. So despite all that, they were cranking out a lot of movies. And so from the kind of crank out all those movies, my guess is that these were films that probably required, you know, maybe one or two sets, you know, so that way it wouldn't take long to make. And so in which case these studios in Korea were going to have this big stockpile of films, but because, you know, they just didn't have a whole lot of money, they didn't have a lot of storage space. And one comment was made by one blogger. They said that the Korean filmmakers back then were very stingy with their storage space. So it sounds like in the 1960s, there were probably the movies are treated very disposable. You make it, you know, after it had its run, and then you pitch it. Especially if you're making movies at the volume that they were making, I suppose they probably saw them as being rather disposable. And so that was very common thing to have happened. Now, one thing that I think is certain, though, is that Far East Entertainment, they're the ones that created Yongary, that they had that movie for at least 2 years because they sold the print to AIP Pictures back in 1969 for television. So my guess is, based on what I've read from various blogs and stuff like that, it's probably happened was in the early 70s when Far East Entertainment went bankrupt because of, they owed a lot of back taxes, is that probably a lot of their film...
Isn't it always taxes that gets everybody? I mean, that's how... They got Al Capone, right? It wasn't because all the murders and everything. You know, it was taxes. That's how they got him.
Yeah. So poor old Far East Entertainment, you know, they were behind by a substantial sum of money. So probably what would have happened, you know, this is just pure speculation, is that, you know, they, you know, since they were kind of in the habit of tossing movies out anyway and not worrying about it, it's probably when this film company got dissolved. Probably a lot of their film library probably got just disposed of because they no longer existed as a company. Now, I do have some other speculation, kind of hopeful, you know, that maybe the original one will still be surfaced, because during this liquidation process, say if the liquidation process is similar here in the city of the United States, and the government may have seized all their assets and auctioned them off in which to, you know, make up for their, you know, debt. In which case, someone might have gotten their hands on the original one and it's just sitting in some family attic somewhere. Or maybe someone in the staff of that company might have just took it, since everything was going to get tossed anyway. Maybe sitting in someone else's attic, you know, who used to work for the company. But, you know, there's still a chance that it might be floating out there. So then August Ragone, he put out some time ago a blog saying, theorizing that maybe even Toei still, since they had the distribution rights, at least the international distribution rights, might have a copy of that movie sitting around somewhere that's been forgotten. But anyway, so it's not unusual that they would...
Jimmy, I would rather not talk about our run-in with, oh my gosh, with Hannibal Chow about that. It's funny that when you were with us in Hong Kong that you were joking about Hannibal Chow, because Jimmy and I had to visit him, and apparently he has a film collection, private film collection.
Oh,
including some stuff, including some stuff you would think that apparently nobody else has. So who knows? He might have a Korean cut of Yongary sitting in there someplace. But he made it abundantly clear, if we show our faces there again, we wouldn't be leaving. Yeah, I know, Jimmy. There is no amount of Kirk Fu and Haikiba that's going to save us next time. Jeez. Anyway, you were saying...
So I was saying, you know, so it probably wasn't that all that uncommon, you know, for films back then, you know, just to disappear because they were just simply just pitched in order to, you know, make room for the next movie that they're making.
Yeah, well, and the wild part is, from what I understand, if this film gets shown anywhere in Korea anymore, they use the dub version. Because that's the only one that they can get. Now, you are someone who has actually seen the 48 minutes of surviving Korean language footage.
Correct.
And, you know, so, as someone who has actually seen it, how can you say it compares to what we have with the AIP dubbed version?
Well, I would say that the AIP changed none of the scenes. And so we don't have, like what happens with so many Japanese movies where things get cut and shuffled and reshot and things like that, like Ghidorah 3, a monster, that movie is, you go and compare that to the original Japanese, there's so many shuffled scenes, you know, they're almost like two different movies. Now, whereas AIP, with, thank God for this, with Yongary, they decided to change nothing. And so I would, basically... You know, that movie still exists with an English dub.
Well, they changed the characters' names.
Yeah, you know, I mean, aside from, like, of course, that relates to the dub. I mean, from actual scenes, like, they didn't say, like, take the scene of say, the young scientist and, you know, and moved it to 30 minutes later to a different part of the movie. I mean, you didn't have that sort of thing. So when you watch the American version, you're basically watching the original Korean version with the American dub. But the only thing that's, like, changed is that the... Because you got that long pan sequence in the beginning of outer space before you get to the Earth. In the Korean version, that's where they had the opening credits. And, of course, you know, we hear in the States, all those Korean characters would make no sense. So all that would have been removed.
Yeah, which actually makes the opening of this movie kind of weird. because it's just this long panning shot on what is obviously somebody's blanket with holes punched in it.
Yeah, well, you know, it's not as weird as you might think for a 60s movies, because a lot of 60s movies would, especially if they're like long ones, like say Battle of the Bulge, will have like this sequence where it's just basically all they do is playing music before they actually show the movie.
Oh, like an overture or something? But no, yeah, but this the weird thing was that this was, because they removed the credits, it exists in this nebulous middle ground between overture and establishing shot.
Yes.
Because what's weird. You're literally just staring at a star field with this really slow panning shot. And only when we get to this model Earth do the actual English language credits start to play. And I'm like, chopped the first minute out of this and lost nothing.
Well, it's a good thing they didn't, because again, this kind of preserves the Korean original.
It does. It does, but I still just find it weird that they left that whole minute in there, and I'm just sitting here like, you imagine being somebody in 1969 when this aired on TV, and you tune in, and it's just like,
I don't think that was
aired on TV. Is the movie going to start? Is the movie going to start?
Well, hang on a second. I don't think that was aired on TV, because what you're looking at now, the version that's circulating now, is like an original print that was found in the MGM vault. I think it was the MGM vault. Sci-Fi Japan had a really good article about this.
Yeah.
You know, and so that was kind of like the print that they had before they edited it for television.
Oh, okay.
And so that's why you got that long opening there.
Okay.
So the television version wouldn't have that.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And so I said that's what makes this that version that the MGM found such a prize, because it's basically the full Korean film without any tampering, aside from the dub.
Yeah.
No tampering with the actual footage, no tampering with the sound effects.
Yeah.
And so forth.
You know, something that I've been thinking about, you know, it's interesting that we've drawn some comparisons to the BBC and in particular Doctor Who, because Doctor Who infamously, with the first two Doctors, there's gaps in there. A lot of their episodes have been lost. Now, some of them have been found over the last 10 years, but they're still piecing them together. Now, one advantage, weirdly enough, that the BBC had was that they still had all of the audio from those episodes. They just don't have all the footage.
Isn't that odd? They saved the audio.
Yeah. So in some cases, they've done reconstructions using the audio. They just have to animate them as close to what they, you know, what they've been able to kind of piece together, what the episodes might have been like, which is interesting. And I'm sitting here thinking, would it be possible to do something like that with Yongary? Could we, if the original Korean language audio track be located, could we just take the dub version, mute it, and then through the magic of editing, put that Korean soundtrack in there, and we essentially restore the original Korean version?
Well, I guess that is a possibility, because the sound elements in the actual film were shipped out separately. So, you know, so obviously it's on a separate track somewhere. So yeah, that could be a thing that we found. At first I thought you might be leading up to using that 48-minute version to try to re-piece the audio. The problem is the 48 minute. Yeah, so if you've seen the 48-minute version, this is what's kind of sad, is that most of the action was saved and then most of the dialogue scenes were lost. You know, and normally, you know, say if a kaiju fan would rather see the action scenes preserved, but in this case, we would have been better off if we lost the action scenes and saved the talking scenes, because then you could have recreated the audio.
Yeah, because I bring that up because I think something like that was done, at least that's what I've been told, with David Callett. David Callett apparently went on this massive project where he basically took the recently restored Japanese cut of Ghidorah the Three-Headed Monster, took that restored footage, and then basically recreated the new, you know, the AIP scene, the AIP order of it, and then just took the soundtrack and then laced that over it. Because apparently all of the original, all of the prints of the actual original Americanized version were just horrible. We're just in horrible shape. So he just pieced it together using the Japanese version, which sounds like a massive undertaking. So I'm just thinking, it maybe as opposed to just trying to find the entire film stashed away someplace, hopefully not in Hannibal Chow's locker, but, you know, just find it. You don't have to have the whole movie. Just if you can find the sound elements, you might be able to just take the dub version, like I said, and just piece it together.
Yeah, well, there's still one more avenue yet now with technology being what it is that, you know, they might be able to restore just by, since we got part of the audio, you can then, with AI, computers, all that, and sort of recreate the voices.
Oh, can we not? Jimmy and I have had talks about this. He's a former NASA engineer, and even he's leery of AI. Okay, yeah. I've seen Terminator. I know how this ends.
I mean, they already been using CGI to recreate Grand Moff Tarkin and Princess Leia for the Star Wars movies.
Oh, jeez! Don't get him started. Okay. It was bad enough when he was raging against the prequels. Now he's starting to turn against the sequels. Okay. Or just Disney Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, before we continue, I had to hit the cough button there a little longer than I would have liked. Thankfully, this is all going to get edited out for the podcast version. My apologies, Kaiju lovers, if I sound a little under the weather. Unfortunately, we've only been in Seoul for a few weeks, and I think I have discovered that while I was in Hong Kong, I may have contracted a China virus. I have been sitting on that joke for the last day. I don't mean COVID, though. I just caught a virus in China. In case nobody got the joke, because we live in humorless times anymore. Anyway.
Yeah.
Anyway, what were you saying?
So yeah, I think we kind of wrapped up the whole point about these, how the Yongary was lost, and how we could possibly restore it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's talk about, you know, actually making this movie, because it is kind of wild, and because here's the funny thing, as was brought up in the entertaining info dump, Japanese pop culture was technically popular in South Korea, but it was also banned. Because, as we'll talk about in the Toku topic, Japan and Korea don't necessarily like each other. They have a checkered history, to say the least. So someone came up with this brilliant idea. Well, I was like, well, if we can't bring the kaiju to Korea, we'll pull a Thanos and do it ourselves.
Yeah.
So that's what this movie was meant to be. Interestingly, I'm sure you know this. What do you know what Yongary means?
Yeah, the first part, Yong, that's for dragon, and then Gari is from Pulsagari. I think it's Bulsagari is how they pronounce
Bulgasari.
It. Yeah, Bulgasari, for the metal-eating monster.
Yeah, not to be confused with
Bulgasari,
which was actually a film made in 19, I think it was the early 60s. I don't want to give 62. A specific year. 62?
That seems, yeah. Yeah, somewhere around that area, give or take a year.
Yeah, that unfortunately has been completely lost. Another example
is how easily these movies were lost in Korea, so this is like kind of a normal thing.
Yeah. Yeah,
I guess there were some bloggers out there in Korea must know something about this, because they mentioned that Bulgasari, that was just basically the actual monster, some kind of doll, whatever, that they stuck in front of the camera was not a really good one. And so they kind of, in their opinion, like Yongary was like kind of their first proper giant monster movie.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah, you could make that argument, but it doesn't survive. So for all intents and purposes, Yongary and Wang Mogwai,
yeah,
are the first. And this was, like I said, 1967, Year of the Kaiju, because every Japanese studio, and you were on for one of the other ones, actually, Son of Godzilla. Mm-hmm. You're just coming back for all these 1967 Kaiju movies.
The first monster was one of my favorite areas of research.
Yeah, yeah. So every Japanese studio, so we're talking Toho. Toho was so cool, they made two. And then we had Shojiku, Nikatsu, Daiei, that's all the Japanese ones, because there were five in Japan, correct?
Yep, and then
Toho had two. They had King Kong Escapes and Son of Godzilla. Mm-hmm. And then, but you're like, well, what about Toei? This was Toei's.
This is also the thing I really I find very fascinating, because you know this is perfect fire's Toei's business model. Well, as far back as 1964, a lot of the guys over at Toei already knew that the writing was on the wall for motion pictures, and so they already had were doing a restructuring with their company. It's long before the rest of the Japanese company. The other Japanese companies didn't get to it until like 1969, 1970. By that time, you know, there was just bad shape, which is part of the reason why they started going into, you know, that, what they call that pink film, Roman type, you know.
Roman porno.
Yeah, that stuff. So anyway, yeah. So Toei, then, like I said, you know, saw the writing wall back in 1969.
Yeah. I would just like to remind all the kaiju lovers, especially those of you on Patreon, no, we will not be covering any of those. We have standards on the Film Vault. Although, I did do an episode with our friend John on Mighty Peking Man, which might have pushed that limit. Of course, there was also Yeti, Giant of the 20th Century, that also kind of pushed it. Anyway, we're moving on.
So to kind of finish my diatribe here, you know. Yeah. So anyway, so what they did was, is to save money, they took like all their top movie talent and move them to television, because the TV sponsors paid most of the budget. And then all their new people, they were then making the movies because you could pay them less. So the theory was, so their business model was trying to, you know, when you make a production, try to find someone else to pay for it. So that's why Yongary was perfect for them, because now they could participate in the first monster boom. Everyone was putting out monster movies. They said, well, we need to put one out there too, but we don't want to use our money. So we use Far East Entertainment's money, you know, and bring over their movies. So as I said, this is just perfect, because, you know, here comes the Koreans coming over here saying, hey, you know, we were looking for some technicians. Can you help us out? And say, well, hey, we'll even distribute your movie, you know, since it's your money that's paying for it. And all we have to do is just bring it over, in which case, you know, Toei referenced them to X Productions. And that's where the technicians came from. And I bet you anything based on Toei's business model to pass the expense on other people is that Far East Entertainment probably paid the salaries to the X Production people, you know, when it came to doing the special effects. Mm-hmm. And so, and I know, although I should maybe add a little extra detail in there, is that August Rogoni mentioned in his essay that Toei did help fund the movie, but I'm a little hesitant to get on board with that until I can see his research material, just because of this Toei business model was, when it comes to special effects, you try to find someone else to pay for that budget. And in which case, it would make more sense to them to go ahead and just let Far East Entertainment handle the expense of the special effects. And also, I think that's a more likely scenario, because I can't remember if it was Kim Kaduk, the director, or the producer, but there was people who were senior, you know, executives over at Far East Entertainment blamed Yongary for the reason why they were having financial problems, because it was so expensive. And so about the only way then that they can make that complaint is if they shouldered most of the budget. But anyways, yeah, so like I said, so the Toei was able to go ahead and squeak out a giant monster movie without having to really pay much money for it, if they paid anything at all.
Hey, and, you know, Toei, let's be honest, Toei is not known for kaiju. They're known for anime and all the spandexy superheroes that they made.
I'm going to actually back you up on that for a second, you know, because actually, see, the reason why a lot of us here in the States are not aware of all the kaiju output of Toei is because in the 1960s, their kaiju output was mostly on television, where the sponsors pay for the special effects. You know, so they had two big shows that were kaiju related. That was, of course, ones that we know of is, you know, Giant Robo, aka Johnny Sokko. And then there was Mass Ninja Kakage, which reused a lot of the kaiju from the Magic Serpent from the year before.
I would say the most prominent Toei kaiju movie that I know of is the Magic Serpent, which, if you want to hear more about the Magic Serpent, go check out MIFV episode 49, where I brought on Damon Noyes, who actually requested that as a Patreon pick. And one of the most exciting things to happen actually recently was Shout Factory is now making the Magic Serpent along the Japanese cut, I should say, of the Magic Serpent, along with six other classic mostly Toei tokusatsu films available in the United States for the first time.
Oh my gosh, really?
Yeah, I'll send you a link after we're done.
Yeah, please do that. So anyway, I lost my train of thought, and I actually mentioned that's coming out.
Oh, you're talking about their kaiju output with television.
Oh, yeah. So that's where, you know, Toei's output for kaiju was on television. They actually were putting out quite a bit of material back in the 1960s. And so they were following the monster boom trend like everyone else, except, you know, they did it on television. Of course, a lot of this material did never made it to the United States. So we're just familiar with Kamen Rider and the stuff that came to the
Right. I understand.
They had their hat in the ring.
I know they did. It's just
the expense.
Yeah. It looked different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so that's why, you know, when finally the bottom fell out on the Japanese film industry in the late 60s, Toei was still thriving because they, you know, made their restructuring, whereas Toho and all the others were all, you know, scrambling, like, oh gosh, what are we going to do here right now? We have to, you know, sell off a lot of our assets and shrink our production and, you know, schedule and whatnot, because they are competing against television, you know.
Right. Well, and the other thing that's interesting, what a lot of people don't realize was that, because like I said, this movie was actually a big deal in South Korea. It is very highly regarded. It's unfortunately become MST3K material because this was in season 11 of MST3K. It was a funny episode, I might add. It was a funny episode. But clearly, you know, though the attitudes are very different outside of Korea, toward this movie, because the director who worked on this, Mr. Kim Ki-duk,
Kim Ki-duk,
this dude was a big deal. Like, the people who worked on this movie were the heavy hitters in the Korean film industry. That's the crazy part.
Mm-hmm.
But you know what would look like the A-list talent in one country may not necessarily look like A-list talent elsewhere, you know? Just like I said, this would have been an A-list movie in South Korea, but if you compare it to what Japan was producing in the same year, it looks like B-list material. But regardless, Kim Ki-duk is kind of, like I said, he's kind of a big deal. He was one of the most popular film directors in South Korea at the time. In fact, I saw a documentary that said that he was incredibly versatile and was credited as to having revived the Korean film industry, because he had a movie in 1961 called Five Marines. It was about five soldiers' personal lives. They ended up going on an ill-fated mission, and it can be viewed on the Korean Film Archive's YouTube channel with subtitles, interestingly. You know, so this guy was making stuff that it was a big deal. So, you know, it sounds like this guy's basically like an Ishiro Honda. I don't know very much of his work outside of Yongary, but like I said, he's a big deal.
Yeah, well, I don't know, you know, if you can compare him to Ishiro Honda, because Ishiro Honda, he was always kind of wanting to do like sort of the art film type pictures.
No, I'm saying that he might be viewed the same in South Korea as Honda is in Japan. I'm not saying that they're, you know, one-to-one comparisons at all.
Oh, okay. All right.
But I'm just rummaging through my notes here to see if I can find some more stuff on this guy, Mr. Kim Ki-duk. Let me see. Oh, that's the composer. We'll talk about some of the other people who worked on this. But the composer, let me look up his name here really quick. It's Jeon Jeong-kun.
Yeah, you probably pronounce that better than I would.
But he was a big deal, too. He was the most acclaimed film composer in South Korea at the time, and he composed for a movie called Late Autumn, which has unfortunately been lost, and apparently that movie's a big deal.
But a little quickie there about the composer, he also did the music to Space Monster Wang Mangui.
He did?
Yeah, so he did. So for the Korean kaiju boom, he did all the soundtrack music, kind of like what Eat the Koopy did most of the soundtrack music.
Wow.
So how's that for a coincidence? He did both movies.
Wow, that's crazy. That is crazy. But yeah, like I said, it was a big deal. From what I understand, a lot of the actors were big names in Korea as well.
Yeah, if I can give you an example, if I can pronounce his name right, because he's still alive and he's still the celebrity. In fact, he's credited as the oldest living celebrity in the Korean entertainment industry. And if I can find his name, there he is, Lee Soon-jae. Mm. He played the astronaut and the older brother of the leading lady, Suna.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Like I said, This is a big deal. This is a really big deal, but again, it just shows you the cultural differences. This is a huge deal in South Korea. To us, it's MST3K fodder.
Well, yeah, I think that there's two reasons why it's MST3K. First thing is that dub. That dub is just opens itself wide open for ridicule.
It's not the worst dub that I've heard, but it isn't extraordinary either. I do feel like most of the dub actors are just phoning it in.
Yeah, well, what I'm talking about is the dialogue. Like, remember the missile scene? You know, I was like, oh, we're all the Yongary any minute now. And the guy just kind of loops his line around.
Every time I watch this movie, that scene catches me off guard. It's like, wait, why are you saying that again? Why? I give the dubbers credit. They figured out how to seamlessly loop the same line in there.
Yeah. And then the other thing, too, is also the fact that, you know, Korea, you know, film industry back then just was not geared for special effects films. And so, you know, some of the things that they did, for example, one with the matte painting, sometimes part of the matte painting included the city itself, and you can very well that sticks right out. And now, say, if this had been a black and white film, that probably would not have been noticeable. And most of the films back then were black and white. So I imagine their matte painters painted for black and white film and didn't do color too often. So that just stands out and says, you know.
Yeah, because Wang Magui is in black and white.
Yes, yeah. So that covers for a multitude of sins right there.
Yeah, like, well, honestly, though, the most glaring imperfection of the effects is Yongary is apparently a cyborg because he's got a nozzle in his mouth.
No, that's one thing. I'm glad you touched on that because, you know, that can show how.
And I remember that because that was actually one of the jokes in MST3K when they saw that. And actually, the bots made a joke about how it was BA. He's like, look at that, man. It's so metal.
The thing is that people are overlooking the obvious here. So, okay, so you can see the nozzle bot. Now, pay attention to how special effects were done back then. Look, the thing that I think is important is the head prop is consistent with the suit prop. If you look at a lot of the monsters from the 1960s, Toho is the worst offender in this, is that the prop head does not match the suit head. And whereas with Yongary, the prop Yongary matches the suit. And I think that has a lot to do with the fact that X-Pro worked on it, because same thing was with the Gamera films. You know, the props of the Gamera monsters match the suit. And maybe that has something to do because, I don't know, I mean, like Keizo Murase, he was like the big suit maker for X Productions. And, you know, he's probably was the biggest talent for that company. And that may have had a lot to do with it. Toro Suzuki, who built the miniatures, he got really skilled at what he was doing. And so maybe that has something to do with it, too. But anyway, you can go criticize the nozzle. I mean, that was like they only goofed once with the nozzle. Other times when they had that prop head shooting the flame, they were able to cover the nozzle quite well.
Or they would just shoot it from an angle where you wouldn't see it. There are two shots in the movie where you can see it. But yeah. And since we're talking about the suit, I do want to give a little shout out to Yongary suit actor Cho Kyung Min.
Yeah.
Because actors need more love.
Yeah, I wish someone would say something about that guy. I can't find any information about him. Did you find any information about him?
I can't find any information about him. I just know that that's who it was in that
suit. Oh, maybe he's like a pastor's son. Remember from that Edison's Frankenstein from 1910, the monster is played by a pastor's son. So maybe that's...
Hey, we've got a crazy Korean pastor in this telling everybody, repent, yeah. when the crowd's evacuating. And the funny thing is, I was like, why is that here? This seems kind of anomalous. Because I'm used to watching Japanese films and Japanese media where you almost never see stuff like that, and when you do, it's weird. That's not the case in Korea.
Yeah.
Which we'll get into, actually, in more detail in the Toku Topic, but actually Christianity is pretty common in South Korea, interestingly enough.
Kim Kanduk was a Christian.
Really? That I didn't know.
Yeah, he was a Christian.
Huh. Well, that's interesting. I mean, Eiji Tsuburaya was apparently a rare Japanese Catholic, so...
Yeah.
Which, I wish more people would talk about that. Like, anytime I read anything extensive on Eiji Tsuburaya, like, I've read whole books that go into the work of Eiji Tsuburaya, and it'll be, like, two sentences in the entire book.
Yeah, even though, like, you always watch the Ultraman shows, even all as late as Ultraman Tiga, they still have Christian iconography, you know, in the episodes.
Yeah, I mean, every Showa Ultraman's been crucified at least once.
Yeah.
I'm like, you guys are pouring it on a little thick here.
Sometimes more than once.
Yeah.
Because they come back as a guest in another series, in which case what happens?
They're like, crucify him again. And they do it again to a sort of in Ultraman Nexus.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't put him on a cross, but he gets thrown against a mountain in a cross-like shape and held there to be tortured and killed. And that's from 2004.
Yeah, and they also have like side characters who are churchgoers and having church weddings and whatnot. Yep. And so
there's a whole episode of Ultraman X where one of the big subplots is about a young woman who's getting married, and it ends at a church.
Yeah, by the way, we're kind of getting off track.
Yeah, we're getting off topic. Jimmy is about to yell at us for doing that. But yeah. So you might have something there, but like I'm just looking over. There's a lot to talk about with these notes. So, with my notes here. So, interestingly, we see an entire Jimmy was very interested in this. We see an entire Korean space program in this. This mm-hmm. was very much a fantasy at the time. Korea did not launch a satellite, let alone a rocket, until 2013.
Because, mm-hmm.
again, as you pointed out, Korea at this time, their economy was terrible. They're absolutely terrible. So that's why this movie is a big deal, because it was crazy expensive. And they present a very idealized Korea in this. Yeah, because that's why the characters are wearing nicer clothes than you would normally see. And they have a space program, even though they don't really have one. And, you know, and all of this stuff, because they're like, it's, again, presenting this very idealized South Korea. You get some stuff like that in some of the Japanese stuff, but it isn't nearly to this extent. Although one major difference, I think this was something that Mr. Rifle pointed out in his commentary, was that it's interesting that no outside help comes to South Korea, unlike in Toho films.
Yeah, let's do a deep dive into that, because, you know, you have to look back on their histories, you know, because now with Japan, they want to, of course, show a lot of, like, foreign nationals cooperating with the Japanese, because, you know, during the World War II, Japan, their closest ally was way over in Europe. So basically they fought the Pacific War by themselves. They basically, you know, create a lot of bad blood with all their neighbors. And so that's kind of the stigma that kind of got stuck on them. It's like, okay, you know, so in which case, you know, try to show the world, like, okay, we can play nice. And so trying to kind of deal with that sort of dark past. You know, and then they had these movies showing Japan now instead of being an antagonist of other nations, but being able to cooperate with other nations. And also that you know, kind of fit what a lot of Japanese are hoping for, you know, is to get reintegrated into the international community.
Yeah.
So that was for real. And of course, Honda has said many times openly that was kind of the whole point of his movies, was to, you know, show cooperation and kind of do basically the opposite of what they did during World War II. Now, Korea, on the other hand, now they're used to being occupied by everybody. And so kind of like the I can't think of the word, but sort of the thing they're trying to fight, the demon they're trying to slay, is the fact that, you know, that they're not a power, that they're how can I put this? You know, they want to show that they could be basically stand on their own two feet like everybody else.
Yeah.
They're not there to be, because they went from being a client state of Japan to a client state of the United States.
Yeah. And some would argue, and I don't know how much I would read, I think it's reading into it a little bit, but there are those who interpret certain things, even in this movie, as basically being anti-colonialist, especially against the Japanese. And what's interesting is there is a building, a government building, mm-hmm. in this film that looks suspiciously like the Diet in Tokyo, but it's not the Diet, the government general building.
Yeah.
Now, it looks like the Diet because it was constructed during the Japanese occupation in the 30s, mm-hmm. and it was modeled after the Diet.
Yeah.
Which is interesting. And you know, that's one of the buildings that, I'm trying to remember if that, does that get trashed by Yongary or at least threatened by Yongary?
That building was trashed.
Okay.
Yeah, the structure that was threatened but not destroyed was that gate they had.
Right. So you can look at certain things like that and say that that's meant to be something of a commentary. It's also worth noting that the place where Yongary comes to Korea, that was the name, Panmunjom. Panmunjom. Yeah. That is where the treaty that ended the Korean War was signed.
Yeah. And since you mentioned that, there's a lot of Korean bloggers that feel that because they Yongary, of course, pops up there first, right? And then the whole path of his destruction actually mirrors the path that the North Korean army took during the Korean War. And so there are a lot of you bloggers in South Korea that say, okay, this is proof that Yongary was an anti-communist film.
Yeah, which is interesting. And if I remember correctly, actually, there was a North Korea joke, actually, in that scene in the MST3K episode. They made some line. There was, I can't remember what it was, but it was like when he first pops up in there. So they made a comment about North Korea. I was like, okay, that's pretty funny. But yeah, it might have actually been more prescient than they knew, unless they had just done their homework. So they knew it was like, oh yeah, we can make a North Korea joke here.
I didn't see the episode, so I can't comment.
Oh, it's a fun little episode. I do recommend it. But since we're talking about this, so here's the thing. About Yongary, he's actually, which is why I'm surprised he went back to South Korea and he didn't go back to the Middle East where there was apparently nuclear tests being done. There were no nuclear tests in the Middle East in the 1960s, people. This is totally made up.
Yeah.
Fake news.
I just thought that was just really interesting because, since there was all kind of nuclear testing already happening in the Pacific, because you got wide open areas that in theory shouldn't, the radiation shouldn't reach anybody. Of course, that's another whole story. But of course, out in the desert, you can make the same case. So depending on if you have other nations that were experimenting with nuclear bombs, and of course, where they go, well, kind of like the same thing we did. We go out in white sands, so they go to their equivalent.
Yeah,
of white
yeah. Sands. Well, wow. And what's weird is that because the original Korean script has survived. The movie hasn't, but the script has survived. And apparently, when they talk about the nuclear tests in the Middle East, the name of the country, are you ready for this, was Oribia.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And the Goma Desert. Although some argue it might have been a typo and it's supposed to be Gobi.
Chris, almost any explanation would work because since they were kind of mimicking Japanese kaiju movies, Chris Toho made up their own nations, like Rolissica, and maybe they were kind of following suit, kind of making up their countries in order to
We know all about Rolissica.
Yeah.
My pseudo sister keeps having run-ins with Rolissicans. Mutant Rolissicans. Anyway.
So, yeah, I think, kind of creating their own geography, their own fictional universe. Now, I think that's interesting. So they had Yongary established as being a consumer of oil. And of course, maybe it makes sense for him to be out there considering you have all kinds of oil on the ground over there.
Yeah. So there's potentially a commentary there about energy consumption and energy uses, which I talked about actually for the original Gamera movie all the way back in season 2. So yeah. Episode 32, I believe that's what it is. You may have to correct me in your blog, Jimmy. Yeah, where I talked about energy consumption in Japan, because what does Gamera do? He eats fire. Where does he find the fire? At oil refineries. Oh, Who else eats fire? Maybe a big horned lizard who eats fire at refineries. Yeah, this is a Gamera movie. Let's be honest. This is a Gamera movie. People say that Yongary is the Korean knockoff of Godzilla. Okay, maybe the suit design. But not the movie itself. This movie is borrowing far more from a Daiei Gamera movie, complete with a Kenny.
Yeah.
Ichi, which the dubbers were just goofing around with that because it's the kid with, I got the itching light.
Ito?
Yeah.
Well, actually, the actual character name was very similar to Yongary's name.
Yeah.
I'm not going to try to pronounce it. I'm going to just mutilate that poor name.
Yeah. I just find that funny because we've got this kid getting into shenanigans. And
Elu or something like that.
Yeah. Elu is the older guy.
Yeah, no, I mean, Pirates of the... Now my curiosity's peaked. I gotta try to find that kid now.
Find the character's name? It was in Jimmy's Entertaining Info Dump.
Yeah, let's see here. What was this? Oh, I don't have the proper pronunciation down. Oh, well. But you might be interested to know, far as the kid who played the precocious child, he was in 26 movies, and he even won a...
Yeah, it's Yu-Young. Yu-Young.
Yes, that's the character's name. But yeah, he won his second Bank Sang Arts Award in 1966. That's the child actor did.
Oh, so
he was an award winner before he was in Yongary.
Wow. But no, so it's just, yeah. So this really has more in common with that. I mean, I guess we can, you know, get into that a little bit here, you know, with Icho, who's friends with an inventor who makes an itching ray. I don't know what practical use an itching ray is going to. Itching light ray, which sounds more like a tongue twister than anything else. And the first thing he does, and this is amazing, he knows where his sister, it was his sister, right, who just got married?
No, it was not his sister, because his sister is Suna. She's the girlfriend of the young scientist.
Okay. Or is it his brother? Is that what it... He knows the couple because he decides he decides that the best thing he could do is put the itching ray on them while they're driving down the highway and hope they don't get into a wreck, because he apparently wants to make the honeymoon start early.
Yeah. Now, I think you're right. Yeah, so the astronaut is the older brother. So it's like there's three kids there. You had the little precocious child, and he had Suna, who was the girlfriend of the young scientist, and then the older brother then was the astronaut.
Yeah, because family, Korea, like most Asian cultures, are very family oriented. So the fact that this is focusing on a family overcoming all of the obstacles here makes a whole lot of sense.
And there was also some government pressure back then to do family oriented pictures.
Right.
This just kind of, you know, over here we make fun of the fact that the whole family was in the helicopter dropping the ammonia precipitate. You know, it's like, isn't that kind of dangerous for the whole family to be there? The thing is that this is what the government in Korea wanted on screen.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's not like they really had much of a choice in that.
No, you know? Not really.
With that, but then again, they just want to get that face out there. Yep, see, family movie. Look, family movie.
See, guys. Well, poor South Korea, they changed regimes about as fast as some people change clothes, unfortunately. So I think they had like five since in a fairly short amount of time, if I remember correctly. I forget the whole list, but it was nuts. You know, so this was a completely different Korea that made this movie compared to what, you know, we saw later with, say, like the remake. But otherwise, our characters are pretty standard, I would say. You know, we got a scientist. The astronaut's a little bit of an anomaly. I mean, you did have Monster Zero, obviously, the year before this. No, 2 years before this. With Glenn and Fuji. Yes, I know, your spirit animal and blah, blah, blah with you. His freaking man crush. But he loves Nick Adams and was trained by Glenn at NASA. We get it. Anyway, but regardless, we got some pretty stock characters. And I will admit, Icho, while he is a Kenny, I wouldn't say he's quite as obnoxious as the Gamera Kenny's got. Looking at you. I can't remember what the kid's name in the first movie. Toshio. Looking at you, Toshio, who's probably a psychopath.
Yeah.
But Icho still does things and knows things that no kid should know and do. Like how to run an oil refinery.
Yeah.
Seriously? And now, here's the funny thing. Some people have thought that when you see him later, he's got the dirty face and all of that. Some people are like, oh, he's probably covered in stuff that you don't want to know what it is. Like, no, I'm pretty sure it's just oil, guys. Mm. I'm pretty sure it's just oil. You don't need to freak out that much. But he's a big reason why we get probably the most infamous scene in the movie, which is that, well, we learn that Yongary can dance.
Yeah.
We have a dancing kaiju in this. And they play what sounds like a surf rock version of I'm trying to remember what it is. It's an actual popular Korean song that actually has like some patriotic or nationalistic connections. I need to look this up. It's a weird choice, to say the least. Yeah. Oh, it's a folk song. It's okay. My note was the boy and Yongary dance the twist to a folk song about someone leaving. It's a surf rock version, which is unique. It was intended to be unique and funny. So, but there's apparently some very specific connection to that, and it does go back again to Korea, Japan animosity, from what I understand. So it's a really interesting choice for why they went with this song.
Yeah, well, it might not be any more deep in the fact that it was a very popular song people recognize. And I guess if I remember from the commentary, you know, I guess other films have done the same thing. It's like when you want to do a joke and you throw that music in there, it always lands with the public. It's just one of those tunes, you know, that they all know.
Yeah, but I guess it makes sense. I mean, Godzilla did the Shea dance just a few years before this, so why not make Yongary do the twist? Now, you could argue that there's some justification for it because he's like, I'm itching, so he's just moving. So maybe it's all just in Icho's head. He's like, yeah, you're going to dance with me, man.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's the whole scene's weird.
But everything I read on all the blogs, you know, in Korea, that scene is considered, you know, humorous. And then I forgot the name of the guy who was doing the commentary of Steve Rifle, but he mentioned, yeah, whenever this is shown in Korea, you know, people laugh. They just love it. You know, so it's one of those cultural things that we are not going to understand, but they understand.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, and along the same lines, I've also read that there's an essayist who thinks the fleeing crowds in this are supposed to remind the audience of the war. Okay. And that the men have their masculinity challenged and the boy is the real hero and Yongary mirrors him. It's like, dude, I think you're reading into this. Please stop.
I think all these messages we brought up is just reading too much into it. You know, this was just pop entertainment. He was, you know, he's the guy who just wanted to make a movie that connected with people. So it was all about pop entertainment.
Yeah, I've already started my research on Wang Magui, and you want to talk about people reading way too much into a movie. Good Lord. Oh, my gosh. That one got... People get weird about that movie, but it's a weird movie.
Yeah, it is.
It is a weird movie. So, looking over my notes here just to try to find anything that's kind of, you know, that kind of funny in this, because I don't know. I'm still trying to decide how much of the humor, or at least perceived humor in this, was intended and how much of it was the dub, admittedly. But, you know, you have lines in here like, you know, it's like falling in love with a computer almost. Okay. Yeah, Jimmy kind of did that. You've got experience, right? Okay, I won't insult your girlfriend's honor anymore. Jeez. come on, man. She's a zillion. They're almost androids. And I also love the fact that the couple who are supposed to be on their honeymoon, and this dude is just so out of it the whole time. And I'm like, get the hint, man. Your lady's like, we're on our honeymoon. Why are you thinking about work? She tries so hard in a very PG sort of way to get the message to him. And he just, it's not registering.
I wonder what times that guy's been married. Remember that line? He says, well, I always get nervous when I get married. He's like, well, how many marriages have you been through?
Yeah, that's the other thing. It's like, how many times have you been married? But like, he's just like, you could sleep afterwards. Like, that's about as... That's about as risque as we can get, okay? Mm-hmm. At this point in Korea. And I wrote in my notes, like, get the hint, dude. Get the hint, dude. But unfortunately, because he's in the military, he gets called away anyway, and the wife is just like, oh. But then they tell him, it's like, it's only for 2 days, and after that, we give him a 2-week vacation.
Mm-hmm.
And she's still like,
Yeah. Well, it's interesting that Wang Mangui starts almost exactly the same way.
I know, it's freaky.
You have a newlywed couple, and then they get split because of a monster attack. And,
yeah, go figure. It's so crazy how similar these movies are.
And then, if I remember correctly, the makers of Yongary sued, didn't they sue the makers of Wang Mangui?
They tried.
Yeah. It's like, well, wait a minute. Shouldn't they go the other way around?
Yeah, I also wrote in here, I think this is a reference to Yongary. I said, is he mad with hunger or drunk with power? I can't... I couldn't decide. I also wrote it here. Chekhov's itching flashlight. I'm going to trademark that. Chekhov's itching flashlight.
Well, since we brought up the astronauts, one little thing I like to point out there, since, you know, a lot of YouTubers out there beat on this movie for being cheesy and whatnot. Now, the only thing I want to point out that actually was pretty decent was his costume, which is one of the few costumes that they actually made for that movie. The astronaut costume actually looked pretty believable.
They do. They do look pretty good.
And you gonna compare that to what Glenn and Fuji were wearing over those huge helmets. I mean, they're like they're kind of stylized after real astronaut helmets, but they're like the size of the old bubble helmets from the 1950s. And whereas the helmet that the astronaut here in Yongary is wearing is more of the proper scale.
Yeah,
and I said that his costume actually looked really decent.
Yeah, okay. This was a line from Icho. He says, "What's wrong with you?" And I wrote, "He was shot with missiles. Why are you waking him up?" But yeah, actually, if you want, not just with the tone and style and everything, the Gamera influence, and I don't know, when was Gamera versus Gauss released?
March.
Okay, so they might have had time to see it, because Yongary whips out a laser from his horn and starts cutting cars and airplanes in half, just like Gauss.
Well, yeah, because I think all that gets done, because since X Productions did Gamera versus Gauss and Gamera versus Baragon, they did all three of the first Gamera movies, and then they did this movie. And when you go and now watch Yongary with that knowledge, that the same special effects guys made those previous three, boy, I tell you, the similarities between this movie and Gamera movies really stand out. Like the, because remember in Gamera versus Gauss, you had the reporter, the journalist had their car split in half by a laser. Then a Yongary of a Jeep that's split in half by a laser. And of course, you had the airplanes getting split in half. And then some other similarities is that the missiles that came out of that hill, that bunker in the hill. Well, if you look at that prop and the prop in Gamera versus Baragon, it looks almost identical. In fact, they filmed it from the exact same angle.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, John, even our friend John LeMay actually says, like, that Yongary has a spike tail like Angerus and a nasal horn like Baragon? Maybe?
I'm not too sure just if the similarities were quite that close. Now, this is I saw on an internet source a long time ago. I can't find it, but supposedly, I guess, the original Yongary design did not have the horn. So, and Chris, now we know this much, is that when Kim Kaduk's, received the costume, he looked at that, well, that's not very intimidating, so that's when they decide to add the horn after the fact. Mm-hmm. And so there was two guys who worked on that suit. Now, Maso Yagi gets credited as the supervisor of the construction of the suit, but Keizo Murase said in an interview that actually he supervised the creation of the suit, and his assistant, which I see if I can find the assistant's name, helped make it, and he went to Korea with the suit. So I imagine then that the assistant probably added the horn then. Keizo's assistant's name was Yukio Fujisaki.
Yeah. But, looking over my notes here, there's a lot of things we can get into. One thing I do think we need to talk about.
Oh, yeah, before we go that far, can I one more thing about the special effects? I have to bring this up. Is another thing that's really strange is even the sound effects were identical between Yongary and the Gamera movies. At one point during the climax of the movie, and when they're at the Han River Bridge, and they're dropping the ammonia precipitate on top of Yongary, he hisses just like Baragon. It was the exact same sound effect.
Ah, yeah, that is true. Now, here's what I was thinking of. The Korean folk song that plays, I had it wrong. It was also the title of a 1926 silent Korean film about a man being tortured by the Japanese for participating in a political protest.
Oh,
that's what I was thinking of. So yeah, I see, just...
Right? talked about that in his commentary.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I just wanted to make sure I corrected myself with that. And the quote unquote diet building in this, it was actually destroyed in 1995. It was torn down.
Yeah.
We need to talk about the ending.
Yeah, this, we found out that kaiju actually have hemorrhoids.
Oh, Yongary. Depending on how you interpret this, may have had the most undignified death in kaiju history. There's no easy way to talk about this.
Well, I can talk about it if you want. Yeah, I still insist that he had some rectal bleeding there, at least from the camera angle. I don't know where else that blood was supposed to be coming from.
Yeah. It's kind of messed up, but that's, I'm just like, is that what ammonia does to you?
that's just very strange, is that they would come out from, you know, maybe if he ate something that caused internal bleeding, but they, of course, he was eating the very food that he lives on, oil. So I don't know, somehow he swallowed the ammonia precipitate by accident, you know, and they're sprinkling it on him, and that caused some really serious problems with his insides. You know?
Okay, I can't believe I'm doing this. I am Googling live on the air ammonia poisoning.
Oh, okay.
Okay, let me see what I can find here. Let's see. Oh, whoop. Nope, back it up. Oh, wait. Ammonia poisoning. This is what ammonia is. Never mix ammonia with bleach, in case you didn't know that. Because that will release toxic chlorine gas, which can be deadly. Symptoms. Cough, chest pain, severe, it says. Chest tightness, difficulty breathing, rapid breathing, and wheezing. And fever. Tearing and burning of the eyes. Temporary blindness. Oh, fun. Throat pain, severe. Mouth pain, lip swelling. Then this is for heart and blood, rapid weak pulse, collapse and shock, nervous system, oh boy, confusion, difficulty walking, dizziness. I think we've actually observed some of these with poor Yongary. Lack of coordination, restlessness, stupor, parentheses, altered level of consciousness. And then it says skin, bluish colored lips and fingernails, severe burns if contact is longer than a few minutes. And then stomach and gastrointestinal tract, severe stomach pain and vomiting. Nothing in here about kaiju hemorrhoids.
Well, that's interesting that they mentioned about, you know, the wheezing, because they had a lot of vocal variations in his voice when he was being, you know, attacked with that stuff.
Yeah.
So, they did their research, and I guess maybe they thought, you know, that'd be good dramatic effect to have some blood pour out of him.
I guess.
You know, doing a little artistic license there, although I've no idea if they really, 10 for us interpreted came from his, you know, rectum, but it sure looks like it, you know.
Yeah, well, given the camera angle, it's hard to, I mean, I don't know how else you're supposed to take it. And every source I looked at, because I was trying to confirm, it's like, is that what it's supposed to be? Every source I looked at said it was supposed to be from the rectum. So I don't know how, I think that is just how we're supposed to take it, which is just, it's kind of messed up. Like I said, most undignified death. But that's assuming you think he died, because apparently, in the Korean script, this is lost apparently in the dub, the Korean script implies that Yongary is still alive.
Of course he is. He's my buddy. He would never die.
No. Yeah, but it's also in the same scene where a reporter jokes that an 8-year-old child should become the country's scientific advisor.
Well, I mean, the top scientist for climate change is a high school dropout from Sweden. So, no, that's not as unrealistic as you think.
Oh, she's not in high school anymore, sir. She's fair game now.
Yeah, she was already credited as being, you know, our top climate scientist, and she was a high school dropout, and she still is. She never finished school. Greta Thunberg, in case you don't know what I was talking about. So, no, you know.
Well, three words. How dare you?
Yeah. You know, it's like, that's not as weird as you think, but we've already done it. If anything, the movie was ahead of its time.
Wait a minute. Are you trying, what is this girl's name again?
Greta Thunberg.
Are you trying to say Greta Thunberg is a Kenny?
I would definitely say she's a Kenny. I mean, her voice.
You heard it here first, folks. Greta Thunberg is a kitty.
I mean, her voice is worse than that itch rate. I mean, she's an itch rate.
Oh, I'm totally keeping this, by the way. Yeah. I don't care what you say, Mr. Producer Man. We're keeping this.
I'm sorry. You know, I'm not going to pull any punches with some of these activists.
She's legally an adult now. She's fair game.
Yeah, well, I know, like, in the kaiju community, that we have a lot of progressives that worship people like her, and it's like, sorry, I'm not one of those.
Yeah. That's funny. Like I said, I want it to be known, Greta Thunberg is a Kenny. That's all that matters if you remember nothing else from this movie, or from this episode, I should say. Greta Thunberg is a Kenny. Anyway. I am totally memeing that. I'm just gonna find a picture of Greta Thunberg for a meme and just put Kenny and just leave it at that. Anyway, so regardless,
yeah, let's leave that alone.
Regardless, obviously the Korean script was right, because Yongary was hanging out on the island and then tried to run back to South Korea because we gotta wrangle him again.
Yeah.
And send him back to the island. Although, since we're on the subject of it, what do you think of the Yongary design in this film?
Oh, I love it. Okay, you know, what got me into kaiju in the first place is my interest in dinosaurs. And Yongary, I mean, he's a combination of Ceratosaurus and Stegosaurus, which is something, you know, kind of the two coolest dinosaurs out there, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like two great tastes in one, you know, like a rhesus, yeah.
Then you need... You need to get in on the Titanic Creations Yongary figure.
Oh, boy. The problem is where I'm going to put him. My shelves hurry are full.
So you'll find room.
Yeah. And, like, you know, I've got, you know, this is in my entire collection. I still got stuff sitting in boxes I can't find room for. So, but, yeah, I don't know. It sure is tempting. I mean, you know, if that image they put out is a indication of what the final product is going to look like, yeah, that's... Even in Korea, they're talking about that release, that figure release.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of a big deal. And apparently one of my friends is trying to take credit for making it happen, because I guess he knows the right people.
Yeah, well, that's awesome.
All right, Neil, I've got a few quick tidbits of notes that I'd like to go over before we move on to the Toku topic. First off, did you know that this film actually inspired some slang in South Korea?
No, I didn't know that.
Yongary Tonka, I hope I may have not transcribed that correctly. I think I got this from the commentary. It's a slang term for a strong man or tough guy, mentally and physically.
I remember talking about that.
Yeah, and it was inspired by this movie.
Yeah, because didn't the Korean commentators say that, you know, he didn't realize that was from an actual film at first.
Mm-hmm. It should be noted that the effects took 3 months to shoot in two studios, and there are 280 effect shots, and the crew filmed 3 to 5 a day. And that's why they were grateful to have the Japanese crew, because that helped them move it along faster. Because the Japanese crew members knew what they were doing, the Koreans not as much. Which, again, seems like a little bit of a trend I'm noticing with all of these Korean kaiju movies that I've been just all of these foreign kaiju movies that I've been researching so far. It always requires the Japanese to help them. Inframan, Mighty Peking Man, this movie, Paul Gasari. They all need the Japanese to help them.
Yeah.
Go figure on that. But, okay. Are you ready for this? You ready for this? You know how we kaiju fans always like to joke about how the German titles in particular for these movies are just kind of wild? Everybody ends up either Frankenstein or King Kong or something, like infamously. I think it is the German one, like a German theater program tries to say that Jaguar is King Kong in a robot suit.
I don't remember off the top of my head, but yeah, I know they, yeah, it's always, you know, King Kong, you know, it's King Kong and Frankenstein are the kind of the two big ones they always keep bringing.
Yeah, yeah. Right. Well, because
monsters, you know. Yeah. It's like,
sorry, I interrupted you there. But in Germany and Belgium, because of the prominence of Toei on these posters, because they knew that that was a Japanese studio, but apparently Toei sounds too much like Toho. So they didn't think that Yongary was Frankenstein or King Kong. No, they thought he was Godzilla. Go figure on that. But this is hilarious. The actual German title. Now, I've seen a couple different translations of this. Like, the less interesting one was the German title was Godzilla Monster of Horror. But here are the funnier ones. These are gold. The other German titles were Godzilla's Death Grip and my personal favorite, Godzilla's Hand of Death. And I'm like, what in the heck? What is this? Crazy Germans. So I guess we'll just, next time I see German tourists come to the island, my pseudo sister will have to tell them, it's like, no, that's not Godzilla, guys. That is wild. Did you know that?
You kind of gave me a little peek at your notes before we started the show. I think that's where I first heard it was actually from you. I mean, I've seen the posters, like the Belgian posters, but I never really took the time to really kind of, you know, read the text of those.
Yeah. And also, one last thing before we move on. There's actually a comic book adaptation of this.
Yes.
From China, of all places. And it was serialized in a children's magazine. But here's the major difference. The Chinese communists are responsible for the creation of Yongary through their nuclear tests.
Yeah.
Because the author of the comic, Shen Dong Wu, who's also listed as the artist, was a displaced anti-communist. So, arguably, he makes the Godzilla connections even stronger.
Yeah.
Because now it's actual nuclear tests, as opposed to just a nuclear test just causing earthquakes that wake up Yongary. It's funny how that works out.
I wonder if they even had to secure the rights first before they can do that comic. Or maybe they didn't have to worry about it, because the Chinese kind of don't worry about that sort of thing, from what I understand. I don't know. It's
who knows? Who knows? Yeah. But anyway, we need to move on to the Toku topic after a word from our sponsor, I guess? Maybe? It's another podcast, most likely.
Are you a kaiju collector hunting down that hard-to-find event-exclusive Marusan, a rare marmot, or the latest Bandais? Then Jake at Toku Toy Town is your new best friend. His online shop is committed to bringing serious collectors and casual fans alike the best, rarest, and coolest in the wide world of tokusatsu collectibles. You'll find everything from Godzilla to Ultraman to Kamen Rider to Super Sentai and more. Love glow-in-the-dark vinyl? They have plenty. Love Sofubi? They're your one-stop shop. They even sell non-tokusatsu items and Japanese books and magazines on your favorite giant monster franchises, all at unbeatable prices. Your items will come carefully packaged to ensure your new treasures arrive intact and ready to grace your shelf. Most importantly, Jay understands your journey because he's a collector too. So, visit Toku Toy Town and use the exclusive code MIFV for 10% off your order, kaiju lovers. No minimums to buy, unlimited uses, fast shipping, and the best customer service around. Again, that's tokutoytown.com, where toys make us happy.
Alrighty then. So, this movie, I gotta say, since we're getting into the Toku topic, this movie is kind of remarkable, even though some would say it's taking shots at the Japanese. There were a lot of Japanese technicians who worked on it, which, again, is fascinating given those countries' history, to say the least. To say that it's strained would be an understatement. the current tensions that they have stem mostly from Japan's occupation of Korea from 1910 to 1945. However, they've been fighting each other off and on since the 7th century because Japan tried to invade back then. So it's an old, old grudge, to say the least.
Yeah, well, this if you want me to add into that thought, because it is kind of interesting dichotomy. I think a lot of the friction is, of course, is between the governments, obviously, and then say anyone who's like very political minded would probably then take on those types of you know grudges. But then you got like a lot of ordinary people who are disconnected from politics and are more interested in just interacting with somebody else and don't care what their nationality is. Because here's like an example I'm just going to throw at you. The actress who played Sunya, I'm going to avoid murdering her name. But anyway, she married a Korean businessman who lived in Japan and had a business in Japan. And so after they married, you know, she moved to Japan. So there was a lot of, like, on a personal level, regular people doing business back and forth. If you were to go to Japan, you'll probably meet a lot of Korean people who live there and get along just fine.
Yep.
So it seems like there was a lot of cross-pollination of people who either as or there as by marriage, by business, whatever the case may be. So that's why I think where that dichotomy kind of creates, like, how come there's all this interaction where there seems that there doesn't seem to be any conflict, but at the same time you got this political friction on the other side. And so I think you got these two different social dynamics happening at the same time. Of course, the politics side of it, of course, you get where the grudges are, then the regular folks who just want to get along. And that's why you got these six, because there was actually six total Japanese technicians, and they were all from X-Pro who were involved with this, you know, and were able to get over there. Although there's one technician, this is kind of getting a little bit of a segue here. I don't know if he really was part of X-Pro, but his name is listed in there. And, oh gosh, if I can find his name real quick. Kenichi Nakagawa.
Yep.
And I haven't been able to find any information about him. And I found a Japanese blog that talked about him. And what that Japanese blogger said is, no one knows who this guy is or where his affiliation is.
That's wild. That's so wild.
That's kind of a mystery for August Ragoni to solve for us. He's real good at digging that stuff up. Or, of course, you're pretty good at digging stuff up, too.
Oh, yeah. Jimmy thinks he can solve that. You have fun with that. I don't know if you're going to have time to put that in your blog or not. But, yeah. It's those are some interesting tidbits to bring up because it's more in the leadership than it is with the the common people, because as you'll see here, a lot of Korean culture is popular in Japan and vice versa, which is interesting. Mm-hmm. Considering that the Koreans banned Japanese culture from their country for decades. But anyway, let's get into this. So the last Korean dynasty, so the actual last independent Korean rulership was the Joseon, and they came under Japan's sphere of influence with the Japan-Korea Treaty of 1876, I should say. And then the quote-unquote Korean Empire was proclaimed in 1897 and became a protectorate of Japan, with the Japan Treaty of 1905. You can tell there were several of these. And then after that, Japan ruled the country indirectly through the Japan Resident General of Korea. Okay? So we're setting the stage here. Japan implemented modernization plans, or Japanimation. Sounds about as bad as Japanimation. Remember that in the 90s? We call it anime now. Mm-hmm. Japanimation, good lord. And that was from 1897 to 1907, and it suppressed Korean independence movements. Okay? So they're really starting to crack down on this. And it's interesting that Japan was implementing modernization plans on Korea because they were doing that to themselves a lot at this point and before this as well, because that was during the Meiji era, the Meiji dynasty, not dynasty, but the Meiji era, where they were modernizing it the country quite a bit. I talked about this in the Zhu Ranger episode of The Power Trip, and I'll probably get into it again at some point here on the Film Vault somewhere. All right, so here's one thing. Remember how I was mentioning, it's like Christianity is not as strange in Japan, in Korea, as it is in Japan. That's because during this time, Protestant missionary efforts in Asia were more successful in Korea. Particularly American Protestants and Methodists came over to the country in the 1880s, and they were very well received. And during the Japanese colonial era, Christianity became an expression of Korean nationalist opposition to Japan. Go figure. Screw you, Japanese. We have Jesus. It's wild. Absolutely wild. And then Japan finally decided to solidify things in 1910 by annexing Korea with yet another Japan-Korea treaty. And it was done without the consent of the former Korean Emperor Gojong, who was the regent of Emperor Sunjong. And Japan renamed the country to Chosen. Yep, this was done on August 22nd, 1910. Yep, and the treaty was signed by, I'm probably going to butcher these names, Yi Wanyong, Prime Minister, who was the Prime Minister of Korea, and Terauchi Masatake, who was the first Japanese governor general of Korea. There you go. So, by the late 1930s, Japan sent Koreans as forced labor into factories, mines, and the military. And at this point, they also forced Koreans to switch over to Japanese names. I read something. It was in an earlier part of my notes. It was about 80% of the population they made switch over to Japanese names. So they're just stamping out their culture. You might remember, I think I talked about this in an article that I wrote where I talked about this with Okinawa. They were doing similar things to Okinawa, the Japanese mainland. So you had a combination of immigrants and forced laborers during World War II who brought it over 2 million, which amounted to about 2 million Koreans in Japan by the end of the war. And this was according to estimates by the Supreme Commander for the Allied Powers. In 1946, there were 1,340,000 ethnic Koreans who were repatriated to Korea, and 650,000 chose to remain in Japan. And they went on to form the Zainichi Korean Community. 670,000 laborers were taken to the mainland, and 60,000 of them died, and 5.4 million were conscripted. No, that's a lot of numbers. It's a lot of numbers. This is why there's such bad blood. We're not even into all of it at this point. According to one of my sources, quote, after the war, 148 Koreans were convicted of Class B and C Japanese war crimes, 23 of whom were sentenced to death, compared to 920 Japanese who were sentenced to death, including Korean prison guards who were particularly notorious for their brutality during the war, end quote. In fact, in 2018, a Korean court ordered Mitsubishi Heavy and several other firms involved in conscripting Korean forced labor to pay more reparations, but they refused. And then two of these firms had their assets seized.
Who seized them? The Japanese government?
Japanese government.
Hmm.
No, the Korean government. Excuse me.
Oh, in Korea, they got seized.
And, yeah. And some South Koreans refused to buy Japanese goods as a boycott. I even found a story about one man who even smashed his Japanese car because of this, which is interesting because I saw a note about all the cars that are in Yongary, the movie, they're all foreign. They had American cars. I think there's some Japanese ones in there too.
Yeah, I don't know make of cars. I couldn't confirm that. Yeah.
Yeah. Japan insists that they paid enough reparations for all of this in a 1965 treaty. That's why they said no, which is eerily similar to some issues that we've seen in the United States. I'll just leave it at that.
I understand, say back in the 1960s, and they're asking for reparations from Japan because you have a lot of the victims are still alive and the perpetrators are still alive. But now when you get into the 21st century where both the victim and the perpetrator is dead, it's like, well, at one point you're going to let this go. At one point, can you be accused of extortion here? You know?
Yeah.
Like,
oh. Yeah.
You know, it's like, it's gonna be like the, we're gonna go up to the year 2232. It's like, oh, you still owe us reparations for what you did 200 years ago. I was like, oh, come on. You know, that's why, you know, to me, boy, this is probably gonna be our hot take. To me, it's after a certain point, this sounds more like a money grab than anything that has to do with justice.
Yeah, I'm not gonna disagree with you there, but a lot of Japan's neighbors are still demanding reparations for the war. And I'm just like, okay, there, it just comes to a point where it just gets absurd. I mean, it's like, how many times are you going to go to somebody who, I don't know, punched you in the face during a bar fight and keep telling us, like, you owe me money for punching me?
Well, this sounds like those SH figure arts monsters, you know, that right there is so expensive. That's a great reparations.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
And if they just hang on to them in a few years, they can sell them on eBay for 3 times the original value.
Right. Anyway, so, but here's the thing.
And then just the joy of Godzilla. You know?
Yeah, there you go. But the most notorious atrocity that committed by Japan against Korea was the conscripting of tens of thousands of Korean women into military brothels during the war. This is still a huge hot button issue. They were euphemistically called comfort women. I've brought this up before on the show. I hate that I have to bring it up again, but we have to, because this is a big part of why there's so much tension. So these were girls between the ages of 12 and 17. Let that sink in. And they were taken under the pretext of being hired for jobs like factory workers and seamstresses. According to the interrogation report of the U.S. Army in 1944, comfort women were supposedly in good health. And they would have periodic checkups once a week. And they would receive treatment in case of spreading disease to Japanese soldiers. But not for their own health. In 1996, a UN report detailed, quote, large numbers of women were forced to submit to prolonged prostitution under conditions which were frequently indescribably traumatic, end quote. I think that is the understatement of the year, if not the century.
Mm-hmm.
Japan apologized for this again in 2015 and offered to pay an additional 1 billion yen, or $9.5 million, in additional reparations for the comfort women. Again, we're going back to the reparations. However, activists said that they were not consulted and they rejected this deal. They're like, here, we'll give you money. Oh, you didn't talk to us about it? Oh, we don't want it. President Moon Jae-in, who was elected in 2017, suggested it be altered. And then Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, who unfortunately recently died in under tragic circumstances, said at the time that the issue shouldn't be dragged into a new generation. Whatever you want to say about Abe, this is one of those instances where I have to agree with him. Why are we still going over this?
Yeah, because here's the thing: what you could do, like, if you want, okay, if you want to play that game where basically there's no time limit to these reparations, well, you can probably dig into anyone's history at any point and say, well, okay, well, here's the point where you victimize us. Where's our reparations? You owe us money back.
It's just going to create a never-ending cycle.
Yeah, I say when both, it's one thing. Like I said, if the victim and the perpetrator are still alive, okay, it's fair game. You know, ask for all the reparations you want. But when we're talking about now multiple generations have passed, it's like you're just digging up an old wound. And then plus, you know, you figured, you know, you're kind of like keeping the bitterness alive. And then you got to have people who would otherwise probably would have gotten along are now, you know, antagonistic to each other.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, here's something else that kind of makes this a little bit more complicated. And it's something that we as Americans are pretty familiar with. Quote, at the end of World War II, Korea regained its independence after 35 years of imperialist Japanese rule. All right. Per the Yalta Conference agreements, Soviet forces accepted surrender of Japanese forces in northern Korea above the 38th parallel. Talked about this a bit when I covered the last war. And U.S. forces south of that line. Korea was then divided into Soviet, North Korea, and U.S., South Korean spheres. South Korea refused diplomatic and trade relations with Japan, using tensions with Japan to rally support for the South Korean government. The early ROK, Republic of Korea, which we saw signage for that in this movie, I think it was printed on the rocket.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So the ROK government derived its legitimacy from its opposition to Japan and North Korea, portraying South Korea as under threat from the North and South. So there you go. So even the Korean War played into all of this. Now, it took 20 years before a treaty was signed that normalized relations, which I mentioned a little bit earlier, 1965. And it was signed by President Park Chung-hee, who, if I remember correctly, I think he was the president of Korea at the time that this movie was made. But again, they went through multiple regime changes. Yep. And Japan paid $800 million in reparations with that treaty. And it was the Treaty on Basic Relations between Japan and South Korea. So, quote from one of my sources, quote, in 1965, the Treaty on Basic Relations between Japan and South Korea declared that previous unequal treaties between both countries, especially those of 1905 and 1910, remember all of those I was bringing up, were, quote, already null and void at the time of their promulgation. Ooh, big! There's your big word for the day, promulgation. Interpretations of Japanese rule over Korea remain controversial in Japan and both North and South Korea, end quote. However, this didn't settle anything, because then you had Yui Sang, a diplomat and author of the book Diplomatic Propriety and Our Interests with Japan. So he told the South China Morning Post that tensions were ongoing for two reasons. One, the 1965 deal did not settle all problems related to our colonial past. And two, it, quote, took away citizens' individual rights to ask for reparations, end quote. Speaking as an outsider on this matter, it just sounds like people just trying to stoke the fires as much as possible.
Yeah.
All right. Now, here's the thing. The United States has a vested interest in South Korea and Japan getting along in order to forge a trilateral alliance in the region. Because let's be honest, with China and North Korea in there, both of whom are openly hostile to the United States needs allies in the region. Obviously, Japan is one of them. And they want South Korea to be an ally, too. But the problem is, South Korea and Japan don't like each other.
Yeah.
So so basically, the United States is kind of trying to play intermediary here a little bit. It's like, guys, we can all be friends here, right? Right? So continued tensions between two members of this alliance would give opportunity for China and Russia to drive a wedge between them. And I would also say, like I said, North Korea is also a major problem. And this was actually highlighted when Russia invaded Ukraine. And, oh boy, we see how that's going. So, there are two narratives with this. So you have the Korea narrative that views the atrocities of war in full view, both in education and in pop culture. In fact, there's even an example here. There's a movie, a blockbuster action film, actually, called Battleship Island from 2017 that tells the story of a wartime revolt of Koreans forced to work at the Mitsubishi coal mines on Hashima Island, a UNESCO World Heritage Site. So it's this moral tale of resistance against forced labor, you know, stuff like that. And similarly, we see a movie called Malmo E, The Secret Mission, a 2019 historical drama about the Korean Language Society under colonial rule and its struggle to preserve and document the Korean language. So they're basically making movies that kind of take Japan to task about this. Japan, on the other hand, their view is that if the atrocities of the war are mentioned, Korea is typically glossed over. There is some mention of forced labor and the comfort women, though, although they're trying to kind of ignore that as well. That's, like I said, that is still a hot-button issue. So it's difficult to reconcile these. So you have Korea that wants to go headlong, you know, embrace these headlong and not sugarcoat it at all. And Japan is like, we don't really want to talk about it, guys.
Can we not?
On the other hand, though, I don't get on board with the reparations, but on the other hand, you should not deny your own history. I mean, if you commit the crime, you got to, especially if you want to maintain and try to repair relations with people, you got to admit you're wrong when you're wrong.
Yeah.
You know, and I guess from what I understand, Japan, really glosses over World War II history, especially the war crimes that they committed. I've heard stories even that they don't even teach in school. And like you go and talk to Japanese citizens, they have no idea about, the Shanghai Massacre and then the Catan Death March and all these things. They're just not told. And so like I said, on one hand, you shouldn't be extorted forever on your crimes. But on the other hand, you shouldn't also go in denial. If you can face that, for one thing, that would be really helpful for relations, just admit that you're wrong. Another thing, too, is also for your kids so that they don't grow up and make the same mistakes you did.
Right, for sure. But there is hope. So in recent years, both countries have done some things like they jointly hosted the 2002 FIFA World Cup. And South Korean pop culture has been extremely popular in Japan. And it's a phenomenon that's been called the Korean Wave in Japan. It sparked a fad for Korean movies and dramas and popular music in Japan. So if you've heard people talk about K-dramas and K-pop, it's not just popular in the United States, it's popular in Japan too. And in return, a lot of Japanese pop culture productions like anime, mangas, and video games have gained a lot of popularity in South Korea. And it's similar to what Japan's done with the United States as well. They're kind of exporting their coolness, they're sending their pop culture overseas and they're making money off of that because people like it. In fact, in the United States, manga is far outselling American comic books at this point.
I've heard.
Yep, and also to a certain extent, Korea is starting to gain some momentum in the video game sphere. In fact, there is an upcoming video game called Stellar Blade. It's going to be on the PS5 that is getting a lot of attention. It's being made by a Korean studio.
Now, all they need to do is make a proper sequel to Yongary, and then their pop culture wave would be perfect. It would, that's what they're missing. That's what I'm waiting for, saying, okay, you guys are really, making headway with it. So what about that wonderful film you made back in 1967, that Scream sequel? Why don't you do something with that?
Yeah.
In fact, seriously, they could play make a franchise of old Yongary. Just like Gamera can have a franchise, and then Mothra can have a franchise, and Godzilla can have a franchise. Yongary can have a franchise, too. I'll die on that hill.
Well, they would have. You would think there would have been a sequel, but they didn't make one because the Korean film industry kind of wasn't in a position to make a sequel.
Yeah, but today, what's stopping today from doing it?
Reptilian.
Wow.
I think I just buzzkilled him hard there.
They can sidestep reptilian.
That makes me feel kind of, because the last note I have highlighted and here about this is kind of a downer. So I'll bring it up, but then I want us to end on something positive. So,
all right.
A recent example of the tensions between Japan and Korea has to do with another prime minister, a very popular one named Junichiro Koizumi, who was prime minister from 2001 to 2006, because he would visit. I'm going to have to do some extensive research on at least one episode of the Film Vault for this, but the Yasukuni Shrine. You know about the Yasukuni Shrine?
Oh, not off the top of my head.
It's a shrine dedicated to deceased Japanese soldiers.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, from World War II, some of whom participated in war crimes and atrocities in Korea. So whenever Japanese government leaders pay homage to them at the Yasukuni Shrine, South Koreans see this as symbolic of Japan's lack of remorse. So it just makes things worse.
Yeah.
But, like I said, I don't want to end on a sour note with this. I want to look at how this film is a triumph, maybe not because of its own artistic merits, because, like I said, compared to the best of what was coming out of Japan in the 60s, it doesn't quite compete. But when you look at what went into making it, that we have a Japanese studio with Japanese technicians going to South Korea
and helping them make a movie that is something very much like the Japanese would produce, but their government doesn't allow Japanese pop culture in there, so they just decided to make something like that themselves, but they let Japanese people come in a Japanese studio come in to help them learn how to make it. I think it's in a microcosm. It shows just how well that these two countries, these two cultures can get along if they're willing to just put all of this aside.
Yeah, well, you see, in the United States, I mean, some people just can't let go. And some of it is because, it just my opinion, because, well, you know, there's money to be made off of strife. And so that's why you can't let it go. And it's, you know, it's probably going to take, you know, maybe a couple of, maybe over a century or two before finally something else takes precedent over this and for me to finally get it buried.
Yeah. And perhaps, if nothing else, this movie, you know, I don't think it's going to become quite the classic that it is in Japan. I'm not Japan, Korea. But I do think it should be viewed as evidence of what can be done when people bury the proverbial hatchet.
Yeah.
You know?
I mean, just on that thought, for let's get another example out there. Okay, so the cinematographer, I think we might have mentioned this earlier, that one Korean, his name is Lee Byung-woo. And, you know, he became a naturalized Japanese citizen. You know, his name was Kan, and so his Japanese name was Kan Inoue. So, you know, he was the guy that greased the wheels between, you know, the Koreans and the Japanese as far as getting those technicians over there into Korea. You know, and then so he must have probably also acted as a translator because, you know, he was trying to teach, you know, learn from the Japanese technicians, from the X-Pro guys, and then teach the Korean guys their craft.
Yeah. I get the impression that there was just a very high level of cooperation between all of these teams. Because you have the Japanese technicians who are, you know, willing to go over there and show them how to do it. You have the Korean crew who's very receptive to learning because they know it's like, yeah, we don't really know how to do this, but you guys do, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe that's another reason why this is a big deal in Korea. You know, you were talking about how it's really just, it's more like the government and the leaders who are feeling the tension here. And obviously there's some regular people who feel it as well. But obviously the fact that they got help from Japan to make this movie hasn't stopped it from being popular.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that's, if nothing else, I think this, if people watch this movie with that in mind, hopefully it's something that they can put into practice for themselves. I think we could all stand to learn that lesson.
Yeah, I guess that way, what your priority is. You want to try to get justice for the past, or you want to, you know, forge a, you know, a healthy future, you know, because at some point you're going to have to let go. And especially once a couple generations have passed, you've got to let go, because all you're doing is creating new strife. And new atrocities, and they first would be a fertile ground for new atrocities. And then it's like, you want to keep that war forever? You know, it's...
Yeah. And then if you set all of that aside, you get a beautiful movie like Yongary, where a kaiju dies by bleeding out of his butt.
Well,
surprised Jimmy didn't have any opinions about that. You have no opinion. All right. He has no opinion. You got anything else to add, or can we start closing up shop?
I think we can wrap her up.
All right. Let's get to it. All right. We haven't received any new emails so far this season. I hope all, you know, those of you who are listening, that you will do that for us. Email us at MonsterIslandPhoneVault@gmail.com. You'll hear more details about how to get a hold of us during the credits, which you should totally listen to. But I do have a handful of YouTube comments for the YouTube editions of our episodes I want to go over. However, this first one is actually for an MIFV YouTube exclusive. It was a little video that I made as part of One Monstrous Moment, Rebirth Edition, with the Omni Viewer. It was called For Toto, and it's about Gamera the Brave. Yeah, so, you know, I highly recommend going and watching that video where I brought on my friend Bex from Redeemed Otaku to once again talk about Gamera the Brave. And then we have someone here, username Martian Man from Mars. I guess in case you didn't know. Yeah. And he writes, I'm so glad someone decided to pick this scene. I only just watched this movie, and that scene was so heartfelt. Specifically, the relay when the kids are taking the red stone from the girl in the hospital. Well, on the hospital bed, I should say, to Toto. One of only a few scenes in the kaiju cinema that nearly makes me cry. And I feel no shame in bringing that up. You know what I'm talking about, don't you, Deal?
Yeah, I still have to add that movie to my collection.
What? You don't have Gamera the Brave?
I know. I'm going to pick this up, but then, you know, things come up and I don't get to it.
You're gonna have to get it from Arrow now.
Well, no, the DVD's still floating around out there.
Good luck with that. You're better off getting it. You're better off getting it from what I understand from Arrow anyway, because they fixed some issues that the previous release had.
Oh, okay. I didn't realize there was any technical problems. Yeah,
at least with the previous Blu-ray. I don't know about the DVD, but I know the previous Blu-ray had some technical issues that had to be addressed. Plus, they just carry over all the special features. So, you know, it's a little pricey, but totally worth it. All right. And then we did have a couple of comments here for episode 82. Our season premiere. Daniel DeManna versus Super Inframan. So our first comment comes to us from Enshoma, who's apparently become quite the fan of the show. He's been listening for the last couple of months. He writes, Super Inframan has at least four giant monsters within. Spider Monster. Oh, wait, I know all about him all too well. Inframan himself. Debatable. Princess Elzebub's briefly seen pure dragon form.
Uh-huh.
And Plant Monster's tentacled stalk form. So I totally say it counts. Thank you. I feel validated now. I just wanted an excuse to talk about Super Inframan. Again. But yes, the movie is so damn awesome that even the picky American kaiju community can't stop it. Amen to that. Super Inframan is one of the most gloriously insane movies. Well, really just one of the most gloriously insane anythings ever made by human beings. And then we have Steve Zilla, 1961. I wonder when he was born. Who left a comment here. It says, this crazy movie is just plain good old-fashioned fun, and I have always loved it. You know what? I am all for all of the love that Super Inframan is getting, because it deserves even more. And then, let me see here. No, I'll go over these. So then, episode 83, Son of Godzilla. Oh, you know, that episode that you were on just a short while ago? Huh? And we have a comment here from Autistic Lizard Productions, so Brendan. And he says, way to go, boys! Son of Godzilla is my second favorite, next to Ebro Horror of the Deep.
Oh, so he likes the island movies. Interesting.
Yeah. Interesting, yeah. Yeah, and then here's one from my friend, a kind of involved one here, from my friend Luke Giaconetti of Earth Destruction Directive. He says, Son of Godzilla is well and truly a movie which is better than, one, its reputation, and, two, it really needs to be. Oh, it really needs to be, I should say. I think a lot of casual fans hear Son of Godzilla, and in their mind's eye, they think of Godzilla's Revenge rather than this movie. Probably true. Which I suspect is why it seems to have a reputation which does not belie its quality. The merits of Godzilla's Revenge / All Monsters Attack being a separate discussion. Uh-huh. You're going to go into that with me with John, actually, in a few months. I don't think the film reaches the heights of the films from the first half of the 1960s, but honestly, it's got a lot to offer, especially given its consciously more lighthearted tone. The enemy monsters in particular, I think, deserve praise, as the Kamakuras, and especially Kumonga, are wonderfully realized non-humanoid monsters. It also has one of the best endings in the series. Oh my gosh, the ending of Son of Godzilla is so touching. So touching. But yeah, we went over that in that episode. And then Luke finishes by saying, thanks for the episode. Well, you're welcome, Luke.
Yeah. Stuff blows around my mind that Jun Fukuda still doesn't like any of his Godzilla movies. And it's like, he made some good ones. Yeah. Son of Godzilla, that was a really good one. I never understand this. Of course, he's passed away now, but I would love to be able to have a conversation with him about that. You know?
I would have too. Because I just want to tell him, like, why? Some of your movies are some of my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And then here's another comment from Enshoma on the Fifth Wednesday bonus episode, number 15, on The Abominable Snowman with Matt Walsh, but not that Matt Walsh.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, the impromptu Patreon episode, because Matt Walsh is a crazy man. And Enshoma writes, I look forward to your 1 million years BC podcast. Won't be for a little while, but it's gonna happen because it's a Harryhausen film.
Mm-hmm.
And I share a birthday with Harryhausen, and I kind of do an annual crossover with another podcaster.
Oh, that's really cool. Because
he also shares that birthday.
Mm-hmm.
So we're like, wait, we're two kaiju podcasters. Speaking specifically of Elijah Thomas, we're two kaiju podcasters with the same birthday as Ray Harryhausen. We can't let this go without doing something with it. All right. So he says, but I would like to recommend two other kaiju / giant monster related hammer offerings for future consideration. I will admit, I'm not as familiar with hammer films as I am other things. A little bit of a gap in my monster fandom.
Mm-hmm.
So he recommends X the Unknown from 1956, about a radioactive mud blob from the Earth's core, and The Lost Continent, 1968, a sleazy fantasy adventure with oversized sea monster puppets and killer seaweed. As long as it's not the one that involves rock climbing, Joel, I think we should be fine. It's a different Lost Continent, although that one had Cesar Romero in it, so... You know, can't complain too much, I guess, other than, you know, all the rock climbing.
Yeah.
If you've seen that MST3K episode, you know what I'm talking about, Kaiju Lovers. Let's also not forget When Dinosaurs Ruled the Earth, 1970, which always gets overlooked and ignored. I think that one is probably remembered for other reasons, from what I understand.
Well, it has a really nice Casmosaurus on it.
I was thinking more like the Raquel Welch effect, but okay.
Oh, well, I'm thinking about the Casmosaurus. I thought it was the coolest thing they actually had. Okay. Usually, whenever I have a ceratops, it is always Triceratops or Styracosaurus, and they had the courage to put a Casmosaurus in there. That was so awesome.
Yeah, I'm just saying.
It's so cool because it's kind of squishy, you know, with little, you know, with serrated edges.
Yeah, yeah. I'm just saying it has a reputation because apparently it's a G-rated movie with nudity.
Yeah,
I don't know how that happened. I only know of one other movie that pulled that off.
Well, it wasn't like the G-rated version didn't have those scenes cut anyway.
I don't know, but apparently, you know, if that ever comes up, I guess, you know, it'll be on the show. I mean, the Retosaurus is in it.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, there's precedent for me covering it. I'll just, you know, I'll add it to my I'll add all of these to my master list for consideration in the future. Or, in Shoma, you can just become a patron and then I have no choice. But, you know, to do it, you could just sponsor it. I'm like, okay, we're talking about When Dinosaurs Ruled the Earth now. All right. Any thoughts on that before we move on, Neil?
No, I can move on.
All right. Well, now we come to a very important segment on the show, the one that keeps the lights on, the Patreon shoutouts.
I shall ask me once again, will you shout my name?
Danny Damana!
Eli Harris!
Bex Rimadim Dataku!
Damon Noyes!
Who's also our executive producer. Basically. The Cellcast!
Eric Anderson of Nerd Chapel.
Ted Williams!
Winja the Ninja!
Hoi!
Brad
Batman
Edelman,
Christopher Reiner,
the Indiscreet One,
Jake Hambrick,
Edwin Gonzalez,
Matthew Walsh, but not that Matt Walsh,
Jonathan Cartwright,
Robert Kidd,
Leon Campbell,
our newest patron, Michael Watson,
Tofu Fiore. Oh, that never gets old.
That's going to be a Jaeger name one of these days.
It's going to be a Jaeger name. You said that the last time we did this. You know, it just gets...
It's going to be a Jaeger name, and we also need a Yongary sequel. Maybe we can get the characters together. That'd be the blockbuster of the century. Blue or minus one.
Geez. Oh, my gosh. You know, apparently what you need to do is you need to go out into Seoul right now. Find the studio that owns Yongary, I guess. Might be a chicken company or something, I think, right now. It's kind of weird. It's kind of weird who owns Yongary at this point. And you just be like, okay, guys, I got a pitch. Yongary 2 Electric Boogaloo.
I don't know about that. But he takes on a Jaeger named Tofu Fury.
So Yongary comes back 60 years later and fights a giant robot. This is blockbuster material here, guys.
Just having Yongary there is going to be blockbuster material. he could take on the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
My gosh, we're getting into some insane fanficky madness here.
I'm using exaggeration to make a point.
there you go. But speaking of exaggeration to make a point, I know that was an awful transition, so sue me. Anyway, we need to preview our next couple of episodes. So, we have our first, well, it's not the first Patreon, I need to correct myself, this is not the first Patreon-sponsored episode of Season 4. That honor went to Matt Walsh, but not that Matt Walsh. So this is our first main line, I guess you could say. Well, not even really, whatever. You know, because the other one was a bonus episode, technically. And kind of impromptu. So this is our first proper, whatever. It's a Patreon-sponsored episode, and it's a double feature. We're trying something a little bit new. It's a double feature that I could easily nickname Corman's Crabs, because it's going to be our very first Roger Corman movie. Yes, we've gone 3.5 seasons without a Roger Corman movie. So we're getting our first one. The infamous Attack of the Crab Monsters from, I think it was 1957, I want to say. I could be wrong on that. May have to correct me on that on your blog, Jimmy. And that's just the first one. There's also an unintentional pseudo-remake of it from the 1980s, although to call it a remake is the loosest definition of remake. But it's a movie that almost nobody else even knows exists other than executive producer Damon Noyes and one other podcast, Island Claws.
Yeah, no, I never heard of that either.
Yeah, I never knew what it was either. And let me tell you, it was a little bit of a challenge to track down a copy. I'm like, I don't even know what this is. I know about Attack of the Crab Monsters because of Roger Corman, but what? It's the weirdest thing. So, yes, we're going to be talking about a lot of... It's going to be a very crabby episode. I regret nothing! Anyway.
Well, I like the joke. Of course, I'm not that age of dad jokes are funny, you know.
No. dad jokes have ruined puns forever, I'm just saying. And then we are going to have another bonus episode. Mostly... I had to redo the schedule a little bit, and I looked, I was like, oh, wait a minute. Technically, there aren't 5 Wednesdays in March, but I've already committed to this bonus episode, so Danny DeMatteo will be coming back again. You and Danny are just going to be all over Season 4 at this point. He's coming back to talk about the other 1967 Korean kaiju film. The just, well, not just, but the recently released by SRS Cinema, formerly lost film, Space Monster Wing Mogwai.
Well, I'm going to tune into that one.
Oh, yay. With Spider King of the Kennys.
Yeah, him. Makes Icho and Yongary seem much more refined.
He, yeah. He actually might make Toshio look sane. That's how crazy he is. So yeah, that should be fun.
Sadistic, yeah. That's...
Yeah, that should be fun. But then, oh boyzer, we get to what might be the kaiju event of the year. And on our show, it's basically going to be a crossover between The Conquest and Godzilla Redux. You ready for this, Neil?
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, I know it's not the right trailer music, but I really don't care. We've got Godzilla Cross Kong, and that's how I'm going to say it. I'm not going to say X. I'm not going to say versus. I'm not just going to omit it. No one understands how to use that, you know, the X in these titles. I generally go with cross, but Godzilla Cross Kong, the new empire. I know people are already getting uppity about this. Like, it's not minus one. It doesn't need to be minus one, people.
Yeah, you know, as I tell people, you know, think of minus one is the main course, meat and potatoes, and then Godzilla X Kong, that is dessert.
There you go. They can exist together. Do you people forget what the latter half of the Showa series was like? This is not the first time that we've seen this, okay? But regardless, this is going to be a big episode. I basically had to just like, I'm not missing this. I have to put this in here because it's good for business and the analytics. And I will be bringing on, actually, a first-time guest, couple of first-time guests for this episode. The first of which will be Donnie Winter of Growing Up with Godzilla fame. He's a YouTuber and a poet and a teacher and all that fun stuff. And I do have another one who will be joining us, but he's so huge. He's so huge. I can't tell you who he is yet. So we've got a mystery guest joining us for that episode. As we get closer to that, hopefully I'll be able to reveal some more details. The only hint I will give you right now is that he too is a YouTuber.
Oh, okay. Well, there goes my guess. I got it.
Oh, you got guesses? You got guesses?
Yeah, my first guess was Adam Wingard. When he said YouTuber, I know.
You really thought I got Adam Wingard? That would have been stupendous if I did.
Well, you said it was big.
And it would. And I have a friend that would tick him off so much if I did that. I know, Jimmy. That kind of incentivizes me to try.
Wait, now you got me thinking of that podcaster from Godzilla versus Kong. You know, I forgot the guy's name, you know, who was nicknamed the other character Tapwater.
Oh, you know? Bernie.
Yeah, him.
Yes, yes. Oh, I'd love to get Bernie on the show sometime. Bernie has visited the island sometimes, and people aren't quite sure what to make of him.
He's one of my favorite characters from that movie. I wish they gave him more screen time.
Yeah, I agree with you. You know, I'm excited to see Gia again. Gia is a wonderful, wonderful girl. I had the pleasure of meeting her once. She kept Kong from going insane a couple years ago. That was intense. But yeah, GXK, I'm looking forward to it. And, you know, I'll be very curious to see how the movie turns out, how it performs, how the fan base takes to it. I'm already sick of the factions that are forming around this because just, guys, this is not as weird as you think it is. Plus, I am all for Kong the Barbarian at this point. Yeah. I love the direction that the MonsterVerse is taking Kong because they're breaking him out of the mold that he's been stuck in for years.
Yes. You know, starting with Kong Skull Island, you know, they finally
Yeah. Also, it looks like Shimo is going to be quite a force to reckon with. And I'm just happy to see the MonsterVerse coming up with more original kaiju who can actually stand on their own, as opposed to, you know, the little one, you know, the ones that just make their cameos in King of the Monsters 2019. The only really one or two of them stood out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but Shimo's got potential. So, what do you think, Neil? You looking forward to GXK?
Oh, yeah. I'm definitely looking forward to it because I really love the last movie. You know, it hit all the right points, you know, because what I really liked about the last one, it was a really good story arc for Kong. I mean, it had a lot of pathos to it. And then when you get the end, the action was just superb when you got the big battle. I mean, it was like the thing you're paying to see, the big fight between the two biggest monsters in show business.
Yeah, the rematch.
And they really went at it, you know, I thought it was fantastic.
Okay, well, now, Neil, we come to the other really important segment on the show, the one that is apparently the most easily parodied, according to all of my podcast friends, shameless self-promotion! So, just real quick, go check out my other podcast, Henshin Men, which is about Henshin Hero Television for the most part, and The Power Trip, a journey through the Power Rangers franchise, which I co-host with the indubitable Michael Hamilton. That one's just starting to wrap up. By the time the podcast version of this episode comes out, our quote-unquote final episode will be out, but we should hopefully have one more once Legend of the White Dragon, which was the final performance of Jason David Frank, once that comes out. Also, check out my author website, NathanJSMarchand.com, and the recently published short story anthology that I contributed to called A Time for Everything, which is a collection of short stories inspired by lines from Ecclesiastes 3. My story in that is titled A Time to Dance. Anyway, what do you got for us, Neil?
Well, same thing as last time. You know, I've got my three kaiju novels out there. These you can find on Amazon.com. You can find them very easily just by plugging my name into your Amazon search box. And, well, unfortunately, I didn't have a sales pitch ready to go for this. I was still doing so much research for Yongary. So, you know, I guess the kind of, you know, the skinny is like, okay, we're going to get with a new Ruby novel. Well, one thing I work on with my books is have a really good balance between the kaiju action and with the human characters, because you always got the factions say, well, we want more monsters, and you got other people say, the other factions say, well, we want more people. Well, I give you both. And the themes I cover are usually, I work in a lot of paleontology themes, like the first book, I Shall Not Mate. It deals with the theme of adaptive evolution. And so you have a situation where you got these race of kaiju that actually are killable by the human military. And so you got this evolutionary arms race, but now they give birth to a kaiju that has its own natural body armor that makes it impervious. But the twist is that the matriarchs of these creatures don't understand adaptive evolution, so they think it's a mutation, so they want to kill those poor baby kaiju. So you got both the U.S. military, well, actually you got the world's military, and the little baby monster's own fellow species trying to eliminate it. Then the second book, again, very quickly, deals with the Permian mass extinction, and for you paleontology fans, you know that is like the worst extinction event that's been recorded in the fossil record. And of course, a lot of the theories behind what caused it is all dealt with volcanoes and, you know, from the Siberian traps up in the, you know, the northern part of the globe. Well, I kind of play with that idea and say, instead of a something that caused the extinction, it was a someone. And that someone is coming back to try to finish the work she started 250 million years ago. And so that's the theme of that novel. Then the last one I got out there, Gilgamesh versus Super Allosaurus, that is simply a mashup of monsters and James Bond themed characters. So if you like James Bond and a good monster brawl, you're definitely going to want to check out Gilgamesh versus Super Allosaurus. Okay, I'm done. So I didn't mean to take up too much screen time there, but trying to get all that out.
Nah, it's okay, man. It's okay. That's why we have a dedicated segment for this. You're going to be fine. You'll be fine. Oh, crap. Neil, can you hang tight here in the studio for a little bit? Jimmy just located Yongary. We got to go get him.
All right. Let's see my buddy.
You see your buddy. Just, you know, let us handle it. We're the professionals here. Okay, fine. You're the professional. Okay. So anyway, you know what? Jimmy, Cue the credits.
Thank you for listening to the Monster Island Film Vault, a podcast produced and hosted by Nate Marchand. Our executive producer is Damon Noyes. If you want to be heard on the show, we'd love to hear from you, so email us at monsterislandfilmvault@gmail.com. Follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, and TikTok. You can also follow Jimmy from NASA on Twitter and our many colorful characters using the links in the show notes, which are on our website, monsterislandfilmvault.com. Don't forget to join our official Facebook group and Discord server, The Markolite Lounge. Our podcast logo was designed by Rebecca Hudgens. Follow her on Twitter and Instagram at super_r_illustrations. Sound effects sourced from freesound.org and created by JP Gant. Our theme song is Wanderer on the Offensive, live edit by B33J, Serax, Juan Madrono, and Nonsensical Lexus, which is a remix of Counterattack and The Opened Way by Koatani from Shadow of the Colossus. Additional music includes Every Country Has a Monster, performed by Jonah Ray, and Chant My Name, a cover by Second Archive of the song by Masaki Endo. All film and audio clips belong to their respective copyright holders, and no infringement is intended or implied. Please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and or Podchaser to spread the word about the show. You can even support us by joining MIFV Max on Patreon. MIFV is a Moonlighting Ninjas media production and a proud member of Pod Nation. Sayonara!